وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله الذي شرح صدور أوليائه بالإيمان وفتح لهم أبواب النصوص بقواعد البيان، وصلى الله وسلم على من أنزل الله عليه الكتاب والميزان وعلى آله وصحابته ومن تبعهم بإحسان، أما بعد. Now the author رحمه الله, he goes into الكلام. Now the author رحمه الله, he goes into الكلام, speech. مبحث الكلام, the topic of speech, is very important. It's one of the most important topics when it comes to أصول الفقه. Because remember what we said before. What did we say istinbat stands on? What are the two pillars in which istinbat? Istinbat meant what? To deduct, to extract rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah, right? How do you extract rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah? How do you deduct rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah? We said it standing on two pillars. The first one was what? Al-dalalat al-lughawiyyah. And the second we said was العلل والمعاني الشرعية. And we spoke about what they meant and we explained that. Here al-kalam, it deals with the first one, which is الدلالات اللغوية. And it also deals with what? العلل والمعاني الشرعية. You're going to learn both of them. So kalam is very important. ولذلك I'm going to read one of the explanations on this kitab. الأصول من علم الأصول is called تقريب الحصول على لطائف الأصول من علم الأصول. The شارح, he said, and I'm going to read his speech and a couple of benefits that he mentioned. He says, وهو من أهم مباحث علم الأصول. That كلام, speech, is one of the most important chapters in علم الأصول. وآسل موضوعاته. And it's one of the most fundamental chapters and units of it. وذلك لأن نصوص الكتاب والسنة نزلت بلسان العرب. And that is because the kitab and the sunnah, they came down in the Arabic language. So speech. ولا يمكن فهمهما. And a person cannot understand the kitab and the sunnah على وجه صحيح, in a correct manner, إلا على ما يقتضيه لسانهم ولغتهم. Unless the person understands the Arab and their language. And that's, he took that statement from Al-Imam Shafi'i. So Imam Shafi'i says the same thing in Kitab al-Risala, Kitab al-Risala, page 40 to page 50. You won't be able to understand the Quran and the Sunnah in the correct way unless you know what? Unless you know the Arabic speech, Al-Kalam. And then he goes on to saying, وَلِهَذَا عُنِيَ بِهِ عُلَمَاءُ الْأُصُولِ. And because of that, the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, they felt necessary, they felt it was important to mention it in their books. وَاعْتَبَرُوهُ جَوْهَرَ هَذَا الْعِلْمِ وَعُمْدَتَهُ. And they considered this, meaning al-kalam, they considered it to be like the backbone. They considered it to be the pillar of this subject. وكان شطر الخلاف الواقعي. Half of the debates, imagine this brothers, half of the debates, half of the discussions, half of the argumentations that you see happening from the scholars of fiqh, in the fuqaha, half of their debates, and if you look at all the debates that's happening, half of it goes back to راجعا إلى الخلاف في الدلالات اللغوية. It goes back to actually دلالات لغوية. What does this word mean? And that he took that from Al-Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah, because of that, he wrote a book. He called it Raf'u al-Malam an A'immat al-A'lam, lifting the blame from the worthy scholars. And he mentions that one of the biggest reasons why the scholars disputed and argued was because of an indication of this word. What does this word actually mean? What is the meaning in it? Now he mentioned a story. The story is originally taken from the kitab Mughni al-Labib and Kutib al-A'arib by Ibn Hisham al-Ansari. Ibn Hisham mentioned this story, okay? Are we all together? He's going to mention a story now to show you the importance of learning speech, the importance of learning the Arabic language, and how that is deeply rooted and deeply connected to the subject Usul al-Fiqh. Qulidalika, brothers, you will not understand Usul al-Fiqh if you haven't studied the Arabic language. That's the truth. Even some of my mashayikh, when I told them I go through Usul al-Fiqh in the English language, they were laughing at me. Are you going to teach Usul al-Fiqh in the English language? People who don't even know Arabic. So the person has to study Arabic language in order to understand Usul al-Fiqh. Definitely. So the Sharih, he says, ولأهمية اللغة في التعرف على الأحكام الشرعية فقد كان الفقهاء يراجعون علماءها ويستكشفونهم عما له أثر في الأحكام. Because of the Arabic language having a strong bond with knowing and understanding the jurisprudent rulings, because of the importance and the bond that is between al-ahkam al-shar'iyya, the jurisprudent rulings, and the Arabic language. Because of that, the scholars of fiqh, they would go back to the people of language, scholars of the language. They would go to the ulama of the language. فَقَدْ كَانَ الْفُقَهَاءُ يُرَاجِعُونَ عُلَمَاءَهَا وَيَسْتَكْشِفُونَهُمْ. And they would ask them to clarify. عَمَّا لَهُ أَثَرُ فِي الْأَحْكَامِ. Wordings that may have an effect on a ruling. So what is this actually, implication does it have in the Arabic language? Because it can have an effect on what? Sa'ad, you didn't press this. It's not recording.
Yeah.
When did you touch it?
Initially, just before you started.
Are you sure? Good. Jazakallah khairan. Repeat it again, okay? وَلِأَهْمِيَةِ اللُّغَةِ. Because of the importance of the Arabic language فِي التَّعَرُّفِ عَلَى الْأَحْكَامِ الشَّرْعِيَةِ. Because of the importance of the Arabic language in understanding the jurisprudent rulings, the fuqaha, meaning the bond between jurisprudent rulings and the Arabic language being so strong, being something there, present, that if you want to know what Allah and His Messenger, the rulings that they are passing, you'd have to know the Arabic language. Because of that, the people of fiqh, the scholars of fiqh, the jurists, what would they do? يُرَاجِعُونَ عُلَمَاءَهَا. They would go to the scholars of the language. They would go to the أَئِمَّةُ اللُّغَى. Why? يَسْتَكْشِفُونَهُمْ. They would ask them to clarify for them. عَمَّا لَهُ أَثَرُ فِي الْأَحْكَامِ. If this has any effect in rulings, meaning this grammatical analysis, or this meaning, or this usage, can it have an effect on a jurisprudent ruling, halal or haram? They would ask the people of the language. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ. And he now mentions a story. أَنَّ هَارُونَ الرَّشِيدِ. هَارُونَ الرَّشِيدِ. The Abbasi Khalifa. كَتَبَ لَيْلَةً. One day he wrote, إِلَى الْقَاضِي أَبِي يُوسُف. He wrote a letter to Al-Qadhi Abi Yusuf. Al-Qadhi Abi Yusuf is the student of Abu Hanifa, prominent student of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. Him and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, and they were the what? They were from the students of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. ولذلك Al-Qadhi Abi Yusuf, he himself is an imam. He himself had his own ijtihadat, his personal reasonings, independent reasoning. He had his own way of looking at the Nusus al-Wahiyyin. ولذلك he opposed even Abu Hanifa in many masail. Al-Qadhi Abu Yusuf. Anyways, Harun al-Rashid, he wrote a letter to Al-Qadhi Abu Yusuf. يسأله عن قول القائل. He was asking him about the statement of the one who said. So Harun al-Rashid wants to know, what is the ruling regarding the statement of a particular individual who said this? Who did he send the letter to? Al-Qadhi Abu Yusuf, who's a jurist at that time. He's a qadhi. He's a judge. He's got a courtroom. He judges. So he sent him a letter wants to know what the ruling in this issue is. The poetry goes as follows. The man said these lines of poetry. He said, فَإِنَّ تَرَفُّقِي يَا هِنْدُ فَالرِّفْقُ أَيْمَنُ فَإِنَّ تَرَفُّقِي يَا هِنْدُ فَالرِّفْقُ أَيْمَنُ وَإِنْ تَخْرِقِي يَا هِنْدُ فَالْخُرْقُ أَشْأَمُ فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ ثَلَاثٌ وَمَنْ يَخْرُقْ أَعَقُّ وَأَظْلَمُ. He said to her, فَإِنْ تَرَفُّقِي فَإِنَّ تَرَفُّقِي يَا هِنْدُ. Gentleness, O Hinda, and to be soft. فَالرِّفْقُ أَيْمَنُ, to be soft and to be good is better. It's a noble act to be soft and to be gentle. It's a good thing. وَإِنْ تَخْرُقِي, if you become stubborn and hard-headed and hard, يَا هِنْدُ أَوْ هِنْدَ فَالْخُرْقُ أَشْأَمُ. Stubbornness and hard-headed only leads to that which is evil and bad. فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ, you are divorced. وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ, and divorce is a decision, an unwavering conviction. ثَلَاثٌ, three. وَمَنْ يَخْرُقْ, the one who is stubborn and hard-headed, أَعَقُّ, is the disobedient one, really, in reality. وَأَظْلَمُ, and he is the one who is oppressive, not the one who divorced. That's the line of poetry that the man said. Harun al-Rashid wants to know what's the ruling with this man. And I'm going to go into details, inshaAllah ta'ala. So he said to him, مَاذَا يَلْزَمُهُ, what is upon this man in regards to his wife? What does Harun al-Rashid want to know? He said to him, مَاذَا يَلْزَمُهُ, what is upon this man? إِذَا رَفَعَ الثَّلَاثَ, if he places a raf on the thalatha. Let me read it again. فَإِنَّ تَرَفُقِي يَا هِنْدُ فَالرِّفْقُ أَيْمَنُ وَإِنْ تَخْرُقِي يَا هِنْدُ فَالْخُرْقُ أَشْأَمُ فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ ثَلَاثٌ. If he says ثَلَاثٌ and he places a raf on there, ثَلَاثٌ, he says that. Or if he says ثَلَاثًا, what is upon the man? He changes the grammatical, just the ثَلَاثٌ and ثَلَاثًا, just changing that. فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ ثَلَاثٌ وَمَنْ يَخْرُقْ أَعَقُّ وَأَظْلَمُ. مَاذَا يَلْزَمُهُ, what is upon this man? إِذَا رَفَعَ الثَّلَاثَ, if he places a رَفْعَ on the word ثَلَاثٌ, or if he's, وَإِذَا نَصَبَهَا, or if he places a nasb on it. And if he places a nasb on it, nasabu ala annahu maf'ul mutlaq. He's doing it because he's a maf'ul mutlaq, grammatically. Abu Yusuf, when that question got put to him by Harun al-Rashid, he said, هَذِهِ مَسْأَلَةٌ نَحْوِيَّةٌ فِقِيَّةٌ. This is a grammatical, fiqh-related question. It's grammar from one angle, so it's Arabic language-based, but it has a tie with a hukum. Are we all together? هذه مسألة نحوية فقهية. It's a fiqhi, nahwi related issue. ولا آمن الخطأ إن قلت فيها برأيي. And I will probably do a mistake if I say my opinion. فأتيت الكسائية. I came to Kisai, the great Imam, Imam أهل الكوفة. The great Imam Kisai, Imam Kisai, and he's one of the Qurra Sab'ah. He's from one of the seven Qurra. Shatibi mentions him. فَأَمَّا عَلِيٌ فَالْكِسَائِيُ نَعْتُهُ لِمَا كَانَ فِي الْإِحْرَابِ فِيهِ تَسَرْبَلَ. Kisai is مِنْ أَيْمَةِ الْقُرَّاءِ السَّبْعَةِ. Because in the beginning, before that, Shatibi says, جَزَاللَّهُ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ عَنَّا أَئِمَّةً لَنَا نَقَلُوا الْقُرْآنَ عَذْبًا وَسَلْسَلًا. And then he mentions Al-Kisai. Because Kisai is from the Qurra al-Sab'a, one of the great Qurra, the reciters of the Qur'an, who transmitted this Qur'an to us. May Allah reward him in abundance. And he's also he is considered to be Imam Ahlul Kufati. He's the Imam of the people of Kufa in the Arabic language. Rahimahullah. Imam Kisai, rahimahullah. So he said, I came to Kisai. And also Kisai has another third position, which is he is the mu'addib, the discipliner of the children of Harun al-Rashid. He said, فَأَتَيْتُ الْكِسَائِي Abu Yusuf said, I came to al-Kisa'i. So who's a faqih here? The faqih is al-Qadi Abu Yusuf. And al-Imam al-Kisa'i is the imam min a'immatul lugha. Are we all together? But look how the fuqaha came back to, this is the moral of the story. Are we all together? How they came back to him. How they came back to the people of the language. He said, فَأَتَيْتُ الْكِسَائِي I went to Kisa'i. وَهُوَ عَلَى فِرَاشِي While he was on his bed. فَسَأَلْتُ I asked him the question. فَقَالَ He then said to me, إِنْ رَفَعَ ثَلَاثًا If he says, فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ ثَلَاثٌ If he places a رفع on it, and he says, ثَلَاثٌ Then he said, إِنْ رَفَعَ ثَلَاثًا طَلَّقَتْ وَاحِدَةٌ She's only divorced once. Based on the Arabic language. لِأَنَّهُ قَالَ Because what he said is, أَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ The reason why if he says طَلَاقٌ and he places a رفع on it, and it would only be considered one divorce, is because grammatically, is like he said to his wife, أَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ You are divorced. Then after that he said to her, وَالطَّلَاقُ الْعَزِيمَةُ ثَلَاثَةٌ And the man who makes his final decision when he wants to divorce his wife, he generally does three. He divorces his wife with three. So this is called jumla istinafiyya. It's two complete sentences. The first one he's saying, فَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ You are divorced one. And then after that he's telling her, but the ultimate, the complete type of divorce is actually meant to be three. He's telling her that. Trying to scare her and be careful, he's trying to say to her. That's if he places on it what? That is if he places on it rafa. وَإِن نَصَبَهَا he said. He said if he places a nasb, instead of saying ثَلَاثٌ he says ثَلَاثَنَّ. He says لِأَنَّ If he says that, وَإِن نَصَبَهَا طَلَقَتْ ثَلَاثٍ She's divorced three. He's finished all of these divorces. Because the woman, she's three divorces you give her is over. الطَّلَاقُ مَرَّتَانِ He's finished it all. If he wants to take her back, he had to be less than three. لِأَنَّ مَعْنَاهُ Why? He has to explain to him now. لِأَنَّ مَعْنَاهُ Because the meaning is, أَنْتِ طَالِقٌ ثَلَاثًا He's saying to her, you are divorced three times. And that which is between it, which is وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ is a مُبْتَدَأَ خَبَرْ which is called the جُمْلَ مُعْتَرِضَةٌ Are we all together? He said to her, وَأَنْتِ طَلَاقٌ You are divorced ثَلَاثًا Three you are divorced. And then he's saying to her, وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ And divorce is an unwavering conviction. This وَالطَّلَاقُ عَزِيمَةٌ is a جُمْلَ مُعْتَرِضَةٌ It's a جُمْلَ, it's مُبْتَدَأَ خَبَرْ that can stand by itself, grammatically. He said, those are the two different answers. فَكَتَبْتُ بِذَلِكَ إِلَى الرَّشِيدِ Al-Qadi Abi Ya'la, he said, I wrote the letter, the response. After he got the answer from Kisa'i, he said, I wrote the letter to Harun al-Rashid, informing him of the ruling. فَأَرْسَلَ إِلَيَّ بِجَوَائِزِ Harun al-Rashid sent me gifts, prizes, for the answer that I gave. فَوَجَّهْتُ بِهَا إِلَى الْكِسَائِ And I directed it towards al-Kisa'i. I gave it to him. It was his efforts. And there's more stories that took place between Al-Qadi Abi Yusuf and also Kisa'i. Go to Mughni al-Labib by Ibn Hisham al-Ansari. Mughni al-Labib and Kutub al-A'arib, he mentions more stories. That one time they even sat together and Al-Qadi Abi Yusuf and Kisa'i discussed and Kisa'i said to him, whatever you do, you'll always need people of the language. Whatever you do. The fiqh is always going to be in need of the language. And then he said to him, I can prove that to you, and I can prove that I won't need you. And they had their discussions, and their discussion took place, and Ibn Hisham mentions it in that book. It's very beneficial. Look at it, inshallah ta'ala. So what we're trying to say here is, al-kalamu speech, it is min ahammi mabahith al-ilm al-usuli. It's one of the most important and chapters that fall under usul al-fiqh. And it's important to know it. And also how important the Arabic language is. The author, rahimahullah, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he said, الكلام لغة اللفظ الموضوع لمعنى واصطلاحا اللفظ المفيد مثل الله ربنا ومحمد نبينا، وأقل ما يتألف منه الكلام اسمان أو فعل واسم، مثل الأول محمد رسول الله، ومثال الثاني استقام محمد.
Speech al-kalam. The definition of speech linguistically means a word that has been placed with a particular meaning, and technically it means a beneficial word, phrase such as Allah is our Lord and our Prophet is Muhammad. The least speech consists of its two types of nouns, or a verb and a noun. The first example, Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and the second, Muhammad remains steadfast.
The author, rahimahullah, it's important that you understand, he's going to now go into two things, inshallah ta'ala. So Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen is going to be doing two things. He's going to go into al-kalam, what does it mean, and what is its meaning. لغةً واصطلاحاً, linguistically and technically, what does kalam mean? He will explain it to us, inshallah ta'ala. And then what he does is, he talks about the types of speech. Those are the two things that we're going to be doing in here, inshallah ta'ala. First of all, what does kalam mean? Okay, linguistically, in the Arabic language, what does the word al-kalam mean? And the second thing that we're going to take, inshallah ta'ala, is what does kalam mean, istilahan, technically? Okay, we're going to see that Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he took the technical definition for the grammarians, and he didn't take the technical definition for the usuliyin. He didn't mention that one. And I will mention the definition of kalam for the usuliyin is different for the scholars of the language, for the grammarians. Okay, I'm going to mention that inshallah. And he then, after he defines it linguistically and technically, Sheikh al-Uthaymeen, he goes into the types of speech. Aqsamul kalam, the types of speech. And the Sheikh, he, pay attention here, he looks at speech from three different angles. Just like you as a human being, I can look at you from many different angles. Let's just say I can look at you from three angles. One is your complexion. Two, your height. And three, your weight. So when I look at you from your color, there's many things that fall under that. Your complexion. If I was to look at you in terms of your weight, there's many ways. Slim, chubby, athletic, etc. If I looked at height, average, short, tall, وما إلى ذلك. Are we all together? Speech can also be looked at from those three different angles, three different ways. And Sheikh Muhammad Salih Uthaymeen mentioned them. How many different perspectives can we look at kalam from? Three different perspectives. The first perspective is بِاعْتِبَارِ مَا يَتَرَكَّبُ مِنْهُ. We're going to look at speech in terms of what is the bare minimum that we can consider speech. What is the bare minimum that a speech can be? Okay? أَقَلُّ مَا يَتَأَلَّفُ مِنْهُ. What is the bare minimum that can be considered a speech? Are we all together? And that's what he starts with. And then the second thing that he's going to speak about, inshallah, is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله. He's going to speak about speech in terms of its indication. In terms of its indication. We're going to be looking at that, inshallah ta'ala. When we look at تقسيم الكلام what? تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله. And that is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله in terms of its indication, we're going to see it's going to be two things. الخبر والإنشاء. It's going to be what? الخبر and الإنشاء. الخبر and what? الإنشاء. We're going to see what they mean, inshallah ta'ala. And the third one is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار استعماله. Speech in terms of its usage. How is it used? Okay? How is it used? And that's going to be divided into two, which is حقيقة and مجاز. حقيقة and مجاز. All of those, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be, إذن الله الكريم, take. Let's start with the definition and the first type of what? Taqseem. So we're going to go through the definition here, and we're also going to take what? تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يتركب منه. أما تقسيم الكلام باعتبار أقل ما يتألف منه. Okay. Let's go into the definition first. The author said, الكلام لغة. Speech in the Arabic language is اللفظ الموضوع لمعنى. Okay. اللفظ الموضوع لمعنى. So two points that we need to stand over. The first one is, first point is, it's a lafz, it's a wording. So, we're not talking about actions. We're not talking about what? Actions. And we're not talking about noises. We're talking about speech. It has to be a word, it has to be words. It can't be a noise. And it can't also be an action. So when we define speech, we say, a lafz, it's word, point number one. What are we taking out of the definition? Actions. We're also taking out of there the noises that are made by other creatures, like the noises that are made by a horse or the donkey or the birds, and all of that is not kalam. So when the author said al-lafdhu, what do you take out? And you take out the fi'l and you take the sawtu dabba, the riding beast and the noise that they make. That's not a speech. Point number two that's taken out of there is al-mawdu'u li-ma'nan. It's placed for a meaning. It has to have a meaning. Are we all together? For example, the word Zayd, does it have a meaning to us? Of course it does. But days, does that have a meaning to us? If you turn the name Zayd backwards and you do iqlab of it, or you make it maqloob, back and front, Zayd. Za, ya, dal. Let's start from the back and we say days. It is a speech, you said it, but it has no meaning. It doesn't hold any meaning to us. Are we all together? Like that. And names like that. That is not considered to be speech. So if for it to be speech, is that it has to meet two points. What is it? Al-lafzu, it has to be wordings. And the second one, it has to have meaning. That's what a speech is. Are we all together? Wastilahan, technically, the Sheikh said, اللفظ المفيد. The author, رحمه الله, here, when it came to اللفظ المفيد, that's a definition, a technical definition for the grammarians, is اصطلاح النحاة. This is not the definition of what? It's not the definition of the أصوليين, the scholars of أصول الفقه. What does it mean again? When we say اللفظ, what do we mean? ما ليس لفظا, that which is not a wording. Again, actions and the noise of creatures, they're out of the discussion. Al-Mufid, what does he mean by it? When he says Mufid, what is he trying to take out of there? He's trying to take out of there kalima, word. Kalima is not beneficial. It doesn't benefit you, right? It doesn't. Because when you say Zayd by itself, it's a kalima, it's a word. It won't benefit you. The reason is because it's not a speech. It's not a speech. Also, what leaves is kalima leaves. Kalimun also leaves. Kalima and kalimun, both of them, they leave the discussion. Are we all together? And these are three, you have to know the difference between. You need to know the difference between kalamun, kalimatun, kalimun, qawlun, those four. ولذلك ابن مالك يسأل كلامنا لفظ مفيد كاستقم واسم وفعل ثم حرف الكلم واحده كلمة والقول عم وكلمة بها كلام قد يؤم بالجر والتنوين والنداء وأل. You have to know the difference between these ones. Anyways, كلمة is not in the discussion. كلم is not in the discussion. Because both of them are not مفيد. They don't benefit. That's the definition of the grammarians. The definition of the usuliyin is al-aswat al-masmu'ah. The usuliyin, they say sounds that are heard, wal-huruf and letters al-mu'allafatu al-majmu'a that come together. Letters, okay, that come together. So basically, the definition of the usuluyin is more general than the definition of the grammarians, the nuhat, because their definition, it encompasses whether it's beneficial or not. So for them, a kalam and a kalimatun and kalimun, all of it, no problem. No problem. And to be honest, we say, لا مشاحتة في اصطلاح. لا مشاحتة في اصطلاح. There's no, inshallah ta'ala, pull and pushes when it comes to speech. Anyways, that's the definition of kalam. That's the definition of al-kalam. Now we're going to go into the first way of looking at kalam. Now we're going to go into what? The first perspective of looking at speech. And that is what? وَأَقَلُّ مَا يَتَأَلَّفُ مِنْهُ الْكَلَامُ. What is the bare minimum that speech can be? The author here, he mentioned two. Sheikh Muhammad al-Musa'il al-Uthaymeen mentioned what? He mentioned two. What are the two that he mentioned? He mentioned ismani, two nouns. Such as, the Sheikh said, such as saying Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah. The second one is fi'lun wasmun, a verb and a noun. Such as istaqama Muhammadun. Muhammad is upright. Istaqama is the fi'l and Muhammadun is the noun. So those are the minimum that a speech can be. The first one is two nouns. Allahu Karimun, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Are we all together? Ama Allahu Karimun. Allah is generous. Allah is a noun. Karimun is a noun. Okay? Fi'lun wasmun. Fi'lana. Fi'lanay ism. Fi'il anday ism. Such as istaqama is a fi'il. Muhammad is a noun. That's the bare minimum of a speech. Now the author is going to go into, he's now going to go into the types of kalima. Not kalam, the types of kalima. And kalima is what? Ibn Malik, what did he say? One. وَاحِدُهُ كَلِمَةٌ وَالْقَوْلُ عَمْ وَاحِدُهُ كَلِمَةٌ وَالْقَوْلُ عَمْ كَلَام. For example, what did we just say? إِسْتَقَامَ مُحَمَّدٌ. Together it's what? كَلَام. إِسْتَقَامَ by itself is a kalima. And also مُحَمَّدٌ by itself is a kalimatun. Each one is a kalima. Two kalima, and together it's a kalam. The author then goes, رحمه الله, وَوَاحِدُ الْكَلَامِ كَلِمَةٌ وهي اللفظ الموضوع لمعنى مفرد وهي إما اسم أو فعل أو حرف. فالاسم ما دل على معنى في نفسه من غير إشعار بزمن وهو ثلاثة أنواع. الأول ما يفيد العموم كالأسماء الموصولة. الثاني ما يفيد الإطلاق كالنكرة في سياق الإثبات. الثالث ما يفيد الخصوص كالأعلام. والفعل ما دل على معنى في نفسه وأشعر بهيئته بأحد الأزمنة الثلاثة وهو إما ماض كفهم أو مضارع كيفهم أو أمر كفهم. والفعل بأقسامه يفيد الإطلاق فلا عموم له. والحرف ما دل على معنى في غيره ومنه الواو وتأتي عاطفة فتفيد اشتراك المتعاطفين في الحكم ولا تقتضي الترتيب ولا تنافيه إلا بدليل. الفاء وتأتي عاطفة فتفيد اشتراك المتعاطفين في الحكم مع الترتيب والتعقيب. وتأتي سببية فتفيد التعليل. اللام الجارة ولها معان منها التعليل والتمليك والإباحة. على الجارة ولها معان منها الوجوب.
A single unit of speech is a word, and it is the word that has been placed with a particular meaning, being either a noun, verb, or particle. A, the noun. A word that gives a meaning in itself without any element of time. It is of three types. Number one, what signifies generality, such as relative nouns. Number two, what signifies an absolute, unrestricted sense, such as nakira, indefinite in an affirmative context. Number three, what denotes the specific, such as signs and distinguishing characteristics. B, the verb. A word which indicates a meaning by itself, and according to its form contains one of the three tenses, the past tense, such as fahima, the present tense, such as yafhamu, or the imperative, such as ifham. So the verb, with all its types, signifies no restriction, but not generality. C, the particle. A word that denotes a meaning in other than itself, including the following particles. Number one, wow. It is used as an attraction showing association between two items of attraction and ruling. It does not, however, constitute order, nor does it negate it except with a proof. Number two, fa. It is used as an attraction showing association between two items of attraction ruling with sequence and immediate order. It is also used as a causative particle showing purpose. Number three, genitive lam. The meanings include reasoning, ownership, and permissibility. Number four, genitive ala. The meanings include obligation.
The author, rahimahullah, he explained kalam, lughatan wa istilaha, linguistically and what? Technically. Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. And he also mentioned the first type of kalam, which is wa aqallu ma yata'allafu minhu al-kalam, the bare minimum that the speech can consist of. And he told us it's two, ismani, two nouns, or a verb and a noun. It was befitting now, and it's appropriate to now tell us what does kalima mean. And what is the kalima? So the Sheikh felt, since he spoke about kalam, and the kalima is part of the kalam, such as Allahu Kareemun, Allah is a kalimatun, Kareemun is also a kalimatun, and they're both two kalima. Two kalima that benefited us, what is it called? It's called a kalam. So the Sheikh rahimullah saw that it was necessary to speak about kalima and its meaning, and also what? Its types. Does that make sense? He started by saying, وَوَاحِدُ الْكَلَامِ one, اللَّهُ كَرِيمٌ. Allah by itself is a what? Allah here by itself is a kalima. كَرِيمٌ is a kalima. وَهِيَ and it is, so it's each word inside a speech. وَهِيَ اللَّفْضُ, it is a lafz. الْمَوْضُوعُ لِمَعْنًا مُفْرَد. We already know what lafz means. We already know what it means, al-mawdu'u li-ma'nan. Because we took that when we were speaking about al-kalam. We just took it now. The only thing that the Shaykh had to add on there was mufrad. Al-lafz means word. So he's trying to take out action and the sounds of the creatures. Al-mawdu'u li-ma'nan, what is he trying to get rid of? He's trying to get rid of that which doesn't have a meaning in it. Such as, Zayd, saying it backwards. Are we all together? He's trying to get rid of that. But he added one additional thing. What is it that he added here? He added the word mufrad. Why is it mufrad? Because if he didn't say mufrad, it's like he's defining kalam. Mufrad here means Allah by itself. Kareemun by itself. Are we all together? قَدْ قَامَ زَيْدٌ. How many words are in there? قَدْ, that's a kalimatun. قَامَ, second kalima. زَيْدٌ, third kalima. Are we all together? وَالْكَلِمَة, the kalima is divided into how much? ثَلَاثَةُ أَقْسَامٍ. How many types? Three types. The kalimatun is divided into three types. And what's the evidence that the kalima, I mean the word in Arabic language, is divided into these three? They found it istiqra'i lughat al-arab. They followed up the Arabic language. And the grammarians, they looked at the books. And they looked at the Arabs, their speech. And they came to the conclusion that the speech Sorry, the word in the Arabic language is either a noun, a verb, or a particle. Nothing else. No one could add anything and no one could deduct anything from it. Are we all together? That is called al-istiqra. And that istiqra is called istiqra tam, a complete deduction. Induction. It's a complete what? A complete induction. The Sheikh then goes on to speaking about each one of those words. The noun, what does it mean? The verb, what does it mean? And the particle, what does it mean? Let's start with the first one. Al-ism. Ism is a what? ما دل على معنى في نفسه من غير إشعار بزمن. What does a noun mean? A noun means something that has a meaning in and within itself. And it doesn't indicate time. It doesn't show time. Are we all together? Does a noun benefit us past, present, or future? No. It doesn't show us. And it doesn't benefit us time. Then a noun, two things have to be present in a noun, or it's not called a noun in the Arabic language. Number one, أن يدل على معنى في نفسه. It has to have a meaning in and within itself. Okay, Ahmed and Muhammad don't mean the same in the Arabic language. Ahmed is the one who's praised a lot, and Muhammad is the one who praises a lot. See, they have two different meanings. So it has to have a meaning in and within itself. Second thing is, ألا يشعر بزمن معين. It can't show you time. It cannot indicate time for you. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, the noun is three types. The noun is how many types? Three types. This type of categorization of noun has been categorized into many other ways. This is another way of looking at it. He divided into three types that's important for the usuliyin. Are we all together? The grammarians, on the other hand, what is important for them is another type of categorization, which is ism mudhar, mubham, and mudmar. That's what the nuhad, the grammarians, divide it into. This ism is mubham, ambiguous noun. Mudhar, a apparent noun. Mudmar, a pronoun. Does it make sense? That's not what he's going to do here. Why? Because he wants to divide the noun into its meaning and its application. He divides it into three. What's the first one? He said the first one is ما يفيد العمومة, that which benefits generalization. كالأسماء الموصولة, like أسماء الموصولة. And the Sheikh could have added two more things. أسماء شرط, he never added into there. And of course, الأسماء المضافة, nouns that are ascribed. Those are all generalization. What is أسماء الموصولة? أسماء الموصولة are الذي, التي, and whatever comes from that. Asma'u shartin are all those nouns that indicate that are conditional. Conditional nouns. The first type of noun is ma yufidul umuma, that which benefits what? Generality. It shows general. Alladhi is owned by anybody and everybody. صح? Alladhi, the one, it can be anybody. The second one is ما يفيد الإطلاق, that which benefits and that which indicates that this is unrestricted. Unrestricted. Are we all together? كالنكرة في سياق الإثبات, it is like the indefinite in the context of an affirmation. An indefinite word which is in the context, a noun which is indefinite in the context of a what? It's a noun, this noun is indefinite. And it's in the context of an affirmation, ithbat. This one shows generalization. It shows generalization. The third type, the author mentioned, is ما يفيد الخصوص, that which benefits specification. It doesn't show generalization. It's the opposite to the first type of noun. It shows specification. And this is the example that the author gave is like al-a'lam. And al-a'lam is a what? Al-a'lam is ismun yu'ayyinul musamma. Ibn Malik says, ismun yu'ayyinul musamma mutlaqa. A'lamu ka ja'farin wa khirniqa wa qaranin wa adanin wa lahiqi wa shatqamin wa hilatin wa washiqi. It is a name. No, names, they show khusus, specification. When you say Zayd, that's a particular person you're talking about here. And what also enters there is al-ishara, asma al-ishara. Hadihi. It becomes specific now. Asma al-ishara. Those are the three types. Now, what's the difference between a am and a mutlaq? We'll come to that, inshallah ta'ala. What is the difference between it? بِعَوْنِ اللَّهِ وَتَوْفِيقِهِ. We will come to it with the permission of Allah. بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ. We'll come to that. The second type of what? Kalima. Second type of kalima. Which is what? الفعل verb. What does a verb mean? Verb means مَا دَلَّ عَلَى مَعْنًا فِي نَفْسِهِ. It's something that has a meaning in and within itself. Okay, so it's like the what? It's like the noun. But what is it pushing out of the definition? A harf. Because a harf doesn't have a meaning in and within itself. A particle doesn't have a meaning in and within itself. But the verb and the noun, both of them have a meaning in and within itself. Are we all together? Does that make sense? Qama and dhahika, they're both verbs. Qama means stood. Dhahika means laughed. They have different meanings. Different meanings. What's the difference? The second point is the difference, which is a verb indicates one of the tenses, past, present, or future. A noun doesn't do that. A noun doesn't show you time. But both of them, they show you meaning. Both of them, they show you meaning. And Ibn the Shaykh said, Rahimahullah, وَأَشْعَرَ بِهَيْئَتِي بِأَحَدِ الْأَزْمِنَةِ ثَلَاثَةِ. It gives you the past, present, or future. Then the author says, the verb is divided into three. Like the noun is divided into three, the verb is divided into three. How do we know that the verb is divided into three? Again, is بِالِاسْتِخْرَى. Are we all together? Based on induction. The Shaykh Rahimahullah, he mentioned what they are. Like مَاضٍ. مَاضٍ. مَاضٍ means past tense. Like فَهِمَ, he understood. مُضَارِعٍ, present verb. Like يَفْهَمُ, he's understanding now. أو أَمْرٍ, or a command, which is إِفْهَمْ, understand, commanding you. If, pay attention, this is important that you memorize this. It's important you understand this. If you ever see a verb, any of those verbs, past, present, or a command, it doesn't matter. It benefits you itlaq. Mutlaq. A verb in its essence, maadi, mudari' and amar, it is mutlaq, it's unrestricted. Are we all together? Except if it falls in the context of prohibition, one, or in the context of negation, two, or three, in the context of a condition, four, in the context of interrogation. Those four forms, if a verb falls into it, it doesn't show itlaq, it shows umum. Repeat it again. Remember that the verb, the three types of verb that you just studied, madi, mudari, and amar, they benefit yufidul itlaqa. They show that this is unrestricted. What is it? Unrestricted. It's mutlaq. Unless it falls into one of four contexts. If it falls in the context of a prohibition, the verb is in the context of a prohibition, then it's what? It's not mutlaq anymore, it's umum, generalization. Or it falls in the context of a negation. It shows generalization, it does not show itlaq anymore, unrestricted. Or in the third is in the context of a shart, a condition. And four is in the context of istifhamun inkari, a question, interrogation. Let me give you an example. Example. Allah says in the Quran, فَاعْتَزِلُ النِّسَاءَ, Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 222. 222, Surah Al-Baqarah. There are going to be two verbs in there, and I want you to look at each verb, inshaAllah ta'ala. Allah says, فَعْتَزِلُ النِّسَاءَ. Stay away from the women. فِي الْمَحِيضِ, when they are on their menses. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ, and do not come close to them. حَتَّى يَطْهُرْنَ, until they purify themselves. There are two verbs in there. The first verb is فَعْتَزِلُ. The first is فَعْتَزِلُ. فَعْتَزِلُ is مُطْلَق. فَعْتَزِلُ is what? It's مُطْلَق, it's unrestricted. It's unrestricted. Stay away from the women. Why is it مُطْلَق? Why is it unrestricted? Because the four that I just told you, which is سِيَاقُ النَّهِي, سِيَاقُ النَّفِي, سِيَاقُ الشَّرْطِ, and the سِيَاقُ إِسْتِفْهَامُ الْإِنْكَارِ, none of them happen here. Rather, this siyaq, this context is ithbat, affirmation. And affirmation wasn't in the one of the fours, right? So it shows itlaq, it's mutlaq. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ is عام. It's general. Why is it general? Because the fi'l mudari' fell in the context of a what? A prohibition. A prohibition. So here it shows generalization, so you can't come close to her in all of the forms of the word. When Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ, don't come close to them, it means جَمِيعُ أَنْوَاعِ الْإِقْتِرَابِ, in all of the forms that a man cannot get close to his wife. Are we all together? Another example. Allah says in Surah An-Nur, وَالَّذِينَ يَبْتَغُونَ الْكِتَابَ, وَالَّذِينَ يَبْتَغُونَ الْكِتَابَ مِمَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا. Here there are four verbs in here. How many verbs are in here? Four verbs. The first one is يَبْتَغُونَ. This is Surah An-Nur, Ayah 33. Surah An-Nur, Ayah 33. There are four verbs in there. The first verb is يَبْتَغُونَ. The ones who are looking for. يَبْتَغُونَ is mutlaq. Why is it mutlaq? Because the fi'il mudari' fi siyaq al-ithbat, it's in the context of affirmation. Malakat is also a verb. It's mutlaq, it's unrestricted. Why? Because it's a fi'il mudari' fi siyaq al-ithbat. Number three, katibuhum. Katibuhum is a fi'il, and it's unrestricted, it's mutlaq. لأنه fi'il amrin. It's a fi'il amr. In the siyaq of what? Fi siyaq al-ithbati. In the context of an affirmation. عَلِمْتُمْ is a what? عَمْ. It's general. Why is it general? Because it's a فِعْلٌ مَاضٍ فِي سِيَاقِ الشَّرْطِ. It's in the context of a what? A condition. Because إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ, إِنْ here is شَرْطِي, right? So now you understand that generally speaking, the verb is unrestricted. Wherever you see a verb, it's unrestricted. It will only leave itlaq, and it won't be considered unrestricted when one of those four. في سياق النهي, في سياق النفي, في سياق الشرط, and في سياق استفهام الإنكاري. The third type of kalima is a what? Harf. It is a what? Harf, a particle. What is a particle? A particle, a harf is, as the author rahimahullah said, is ما دل على معنى في غيره. It is something where its meaning becomes clear in a context. The meaning is not connected to it in it by itself. Are we all together? Like for example, the ba, is this ba ul ilsaq? Is it not? It won't become clear until you put it into a context. Until you put it into a context. Are we all together? Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned two types of, or four types, sorry, of particles. Four types of huruf. The first one he said, it is what? Al-waw, waw. The sheikh chose waw. According to the grammarians, number one, and B, according to the Nuhat the Usuliyin. So according to the Usuliyin, the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, and the Nuhat, the grammarians, the waw, it benefits mutlaq al-jam'i. A combination of things. You're combining things. You're bringing two things together. And you're showing that they both share the ruling. That the two things, they share the same ruling. But the waw, as the author rahimahullah here mentioned, وَتَأْتِي عَاطِفَةً فَتُفِيدُ اشْتِرَاكَ الْمُتَعَاطِفَيْنِ فِي الْحُكْمِ. The two things, they share the ruling. But وَلَا تَقْتَضِي التَّرْتِيبَ وَلَا تُنَافِهِ. It doesn't show a sequence. The waw doesn't show a sequence. It doesn't indicate a sequence. It doesn't affirm a sequence here. Nor does it negate it unless there's an external evidence to show so. Let me tell you, give you an example. An example is جَاءَ زَيْدٌ وَعَمْرٌ. Zayd came and Amr came. Both of them, they have something that they share. They share a ruling. The ruling which they share is mutlaqul maji'i. Both of them came. This ruling, this act of coming, they both share that. Zayd came and Amr came. Both of them came. But you don't know who came first. Because you said ja'a Zaydun wa Amr. You can't say, just because Zayd was mentioned first, that Amr was last and Zayd was first. You can't. The waw doesn't show you a sequence. Nor does it negate it, nor does it affirm it. Are we all together? Let's give you an example that can make it clear. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the ayah came down in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 158, إِنَّ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. That Safa and Marwa are from the symbols of Al-Islam. Safa and Marwa are what? They are from the symbols of Al-Islam. Sha'air al-Islam. From the symbols of Al-Islam. The Sahabas, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they said, Ya Rasulullah, which one should we start from? And these are Arab. These are Arabs. The ayah says, Inna safa wal marwa. If the waw showed order, they would have known which one to start with. They didn't. So they asked the messenger, they said, Ya Rasulullah, which one should we start with? And then the messenger had to say to them, Ibda'u. بِمَا بَدَأَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. Start with that which Allah started with. أَمَا إِبْدَأْ بِمَا بَدَأَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. Those are two different wordings. Those are the two different wordings. The first wording is in Surah Nisa'i and the second was in, it's in other books of hadith. I mean, even Al-Imam Nisa'i narrated about both wordings. Another evidence that shows that the waw does not affirm a sequence, nor does it negate a sequence unless there comes an external evidence to show otherwise. Is the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is found in Sahih Muslim. Al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, min hadith Samurat ibn Jundub. Samurat ibn Jundub, he said, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَحَبُّ الْكَلَامِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَرْبَعٌ. Four speeches are most beloved to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together? أَحَبُّ الْكَلَامِ, the most beloved speech to Allah Azza wa Jalla are four. سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. Those are the four most beloved speeches to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. The Messenger then said, لَا يَضُرُّكَ بِأَيِّهِنَّ بَدَأْتَ. And it doesn't harm. And it's no problem whichever of those you start with. It doesn't matter whichever of those you start with. But look at the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? Subhanallah, walhamdulillah. And he said, wala ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. He mentioned, wow, 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 wow. But why did he say at the ending? Why did he say, la yadurruka bi ayyihinna bada'ta? It doesn't matter whichever of those you start with. Because the wow doesn't show a sequence. When we say it doesn't show it, we're trying to say it doesn't affirm a sequence, nor does it negate a sequence. Okay? Then the author, rahimahullah, he went into the second harf, which is al-fa. And the Shaykh, rahimahullah, mentioned two meanings for the fa. He mentioned how many meanings for the fa? Two meanings for the fa. The first one he mentioned for it is atf. Atf here means what we affirmed for the waw. Are we all together? The fa and the waw, they do the same in terms of مطلق الجمع, they bring two things together in the ruling. اشتراك المتعاطفين في الحكم, just like the wow, but the fa has an extra thing here. What does it have? Has an extra point, which is it shows sequence. The fa does show sequence, shows sequence. So the fa, the first meaning that it has is العطف. فتفيد الاشتراك المتعاطفين في الحكم. These two things, they share ruling. Are we all together? So whatever the wa was showing, the fa shows it, and even extra, which is sequence. Example, Allah said to Nabi Musa and Harun, اذهبَ إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Fir'aun, he has exceeded his limits. He has transgressed. He's become a tyrannical leader. He has claimed that he's the Lord. اذهبَ إلى فرعون إنه طغى. طغى means when the person goes over his boundaries, beyond his limits. Allah said that to Nabi Musa and Harun. فقولا له. فقولا له قولا لينا لعله يتذكر ويخشى. So which one comes first? Going to him comes first. So go to him, then say this to him. There's a sequence. إذهبا إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Fir'aun, he has transgressed and exceeded his limits. فقولا له, and say to him. Meaning they can only say that after they've gone to him. Are we all together? So the fa has shown us sequence that they first had to go to Fir'aun, and then after they went to Fir'aun, they can say to him in a soft, gentle way and reminding him of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. That's the fa. That is the fa. Also the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many ahadiths, there's no need to mention, the ayah is enough. Let's go to the second usage for the fa that the Shaykh rahimahullah mentioned, which is al-sababiyya. Which is what? Al-sababiyya. Sababiyya means what? Reason. You're given a reason to something. You're given a illa, a reason. What was the translation that you used? What did he say? The fa' al-sababiyya. Yeah? Ha, it's a causative, it's a cause, it's a reason for something. Ta'lil, illa. Okay, an example for that is that the Prophet's statement, man akal al-basal, anyone who eats an onion or he eats garlic. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَلَا يَقْرَبَنَّ, he should not come close to, فَلَا يَقْرَبَنَّ مَسْجِدَنَا, he should not come close to our masjid. Okay, why? فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ, because the angels, تَتَأَذَّى مِمَّا تَتَأَذَّى مِنْهُ بَنُوا آدَمُ, they find harm in that which the people, the children of Adam find harm in. Then the smell in the salah, the people are praying and they find problems and they're going to find it hard to pray and to focus and to have khushu' in the prayer. The same with the angels. They will harm the angels the same. The fa in the word, فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ تَتَأَذَّى مِمَّا تَتَأَذَّى مِنْهُ بَنُوا آدَمُ, that fa is called fa al-sababiyyah. The reason why it's prohibited here is because the children of Adam and the angels, both of them, are going to find harm from you. Are you with me, brother? Another example is Sahara Bakrun. Bakr stayed up all night. فَنَامَ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ, then he slept from Salat al-Fajr. Look what I just said. Sahara Bakrun. Bakr, he stayed up all night. فَنَامَ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ, and then he slept from Salat al-Fajr. The reason why he slept from Salat al-Fajr is what? He stayed up. And he just slept before, just before Fajr. So the fa here is fa al-sababiyya. We've taken the second harf that the author mentioned. The third harf that the author mentioned is al-lamul jarra. What is it? Al-lamul jarra. The lamul jarra has two meanings. Okay? The lam al-jarra is the lam that places jar on the ism. It's majrur. وهي تدل على معان, and it has many meanings. Okay, it has what? It has many meanings. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he mentioned three of them. How many meanings did he mention? The Shaykh mentioned three meanings, and we're going to mention the three. And we're going to give examples. The first one is the ta'lil, same, accusative, reasoning. As Allah said in the ayah, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ Muhammad, we send the reminder and the revelation onto you. لِتُبَيِّنَ The reason why we sent the Qur'an and the Sunnah onto you is so you can clarify it for the people. And the lam here is lam al-ta'lil, the lam of reasoning. Accusative now, accusative, huh? Causative, sorry. The causative, the first type of lam is lam al-ta'lil, causative lam, which is that the reason why the Quran was sent down and the Sunnah on the Messenger is so he can clarify it for the people. مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ The second one is ownership, التَّمْلِيك, ownership, which is وَهَبْتُ لِعَمْرٍ I gifted لِعَمْرٍ for عَمَر كِتَابُ الرَّوْضِ الرَّوْضُ الْمُرْبِعِ by Mansur ibn Idris al-Buhuti. Look what you said. وَهَبْتُ لِعَمْرٍ Are we all together? So عَمْرٍ here, the lamb that is in it is what? تَمْلِيك, ownership. I gifted to him so he can own. What is he going to own? The kitab, رَوْضُ الْمُرْبِعِ Which is the sharah of what? زَادُ الْمُسْتَقْنِعِ By Mansur ibn Idris al-Buhuti, شَارِحُ الْمَذْهَبِ they call him. The third type is الْإِبَاحَ Permissible. I'm a permitted. For example, you say لِلْرَجُولِ أَنْ يَسْتَمْتِعَ بِمْرَأَتِهِ وَهِيَ حَائِضْ فِي مَعَدَ الْفَرْجِ لِلْرَجُولِ It is for the man, meaning it's permissible for the man to enjoy his wife while she's on her menstruation except the private part. He can enjoy every other part of her body. What do you put in there? لِلْرَجُولِ For the man is, meaning this is إِبَاحَ, permissible, it's allowed. لِلْمَرْأَةِ أَن تَلْبِسَ It is permissible for the woman to dress with مِنَ الْحُلِي These adornments مَا جَرَتْ بِهِ الْعَادَ As long as it's the customs. Are you with me? What about the author mentions عَلَى الْجَارَةِ The عَلَى now. عَلَى الْجَارَةِ The author mentioned only one meaning for it. And we're going to add another meaning in there. Which is الْوُجُوبِ Ta'ala, it shows first of all obligation. For example, what did Allah say in the ayah? وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ Means upon the people to come with Hajj. The second meaning that the word عَلَى has is الْاِسْتِعْلَاء, high. الرَّحْمَانُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى الرَّحْمَانُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى إِسْتِعْلَى عَلَى وَارْتَفَعَ Allah is above his throne, subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it's the consensus of the pious predecessors. It's the consensus of what? Salaf al-Salih. It's the consensus of the companions that Allah is above his throne. It's the consensus of the Salaf al-Salih, the three noble generation. It's the consensus. As Abu Amr al-Talmanki, rahimahullah, transmitted that consensus. Pay attention. Harf in all of its types, بأنواعه in all of its types, لا يدل على عموم ولا خصوص ولا إطلاق. A harf does not show generalization. It does not show specification, and it doesn't show this text is unrestricted. Harf doesn't do any of that. Okay. The author then says, رحمه الله تعالى أقسام الكلام ينقسم الكلام باعتبار إمكان ووصفه بالصدق وعدمه إلى قسمين خبر وإنشاء فالخبر ما يمكن أن يوصف بالصدق أو الكذب لذاته فخرج بقولنا ما يمكن أن يوصف بالصدق والكذب الإنشاء لأنه لا يمكن فيه ذلك فإن مدلوله ليس مخبرا عنه حتى يمكن أن يقال إنه صدق أو كذب وخرج بقولنا لذاته الخبر الذي لا يحتمل الصدق أو لا يحتمل الكذب وخرج بقولنا لذاته الخبر الذي لا يحتمل الصدق أو لا يحتمل الكذب باعتبار المخبر به وذلك أن الخبر من حيث المخبر ثلاثة أقسام الأول ما لا يمكن وصفه بالكذب كخبر الله ورسوله الثابت عنه الثاني ما لا يمكن وصفه بالصدق كالخبر عن المستحيل شرعا أو عقلا فالأول كخبر مدعي الرسالة بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والثاني كالخبر عن اجتماع النقيضين كالحركة والسكون في عين واحدة في زمن واحد الثالث ما يمكن أن يوصف بالصدق والكذب إما على سواء أو مع رجحان أحدهما كإخبار شخص عن قدوم غائب ونحوه والإنشاء ما لا يمكن أن يوصف بالصدق والكذب ومنه الأمر والنهي كقوله تعالى واعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا وقد يكون الكلام خبرا إنشاء باعتبارين كصيغ العقود اللفظية مثل بعت وقبلت أما بعت بعت وقبلت فإنها باعتبار دلالتها على ما في نفس العقيد خبر وباعتبار ترتب العقد عليها إنشاء وقد يأتي الكلام بصورة الخبر والمراد به الإنشاء وبالعكس للفائدة مثال الأول قوله تعالى والمطلقات يتربصن بأنفسهن ثلاثة قروء فقوله يتربصن بصورة الخبر والمراد بها الأمر وفائدة ذلك تأكيد فعل المأمور به حتى كأنه أمر واقع يتحدث عنه كصفة من صفات المأمور ومثال العكس قوله تعالى وقال الذين كفروا للذين آمنوا اتبعوا سبيلنا ولنحمل خطاياكم وما هم بحاملين من خطاياهم فقوله ولنحمل بصورة الأمر والمراد بها الخبر أي ونحن نحمل وفائدة ذلك تنزيل الشيء المخبر عنه منزلة المفروض الملزم به
Parts of speech. Speech is divided with regards to its potential of being truthful or not into two parts, al-khabar, news, and insha, that which is established. Number one, al-khabar, that which can be described as truthful or untruthful in and of itself. What is excluded from our statement, that which can be described as truthful or untruthful is al-insha. Because it isn't possible, its significance is not informed of until it can be said it is a truth or a lie. And what is also excluded from our statement in and of itself is that which has no possibility of being truthful or is untruthful with regards to what it is being informed of. That is because the news with regards to what it is being informed of is of three types. Number one, what cannot be described as lying, such as the khabar, information from Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is established from them. Number two, what cannot be described as honest, such as the news that is impossible both in the legislation or intellect. The first example of which is the news of someone who claims messengership after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the second, the news of two opposing things coming together, such as movement and being still at the same time. Number three, what can be described as truthful and untruthful either equally or with a preference of one of them, such as the news that a person absent is arriving and the like. Number two, al-insha, what has been established. What cannot be described as truthful or untruthful from which are the commands and prohibitions, as in the saying of the Most High, worship Allah and associate nothing with Him. Speech can be both khabar and insha in two ways. In the wording of a verbal contract such as I sold and accepted something, so this with respect to what the intent of the contractor is would be a khabar, but a consequence of the contract is insha. Speech comes in the form of news, but what is meant is insha and vice versa for a benefit. The first example, the statement of the Most High, the divorced women should remain in waiting for three periods. So the statement, they should wait for three periods, is in the form of news, and what is intended by it is a command. The benefit of that to emphasize the action of the one being commanded as if he is ordering what is the reality, mentioning it as a description from the descriptions of that which is commanded. An example of the opposite is the verse, and those who disbelieve say to those who believe, follow our way and we will carry your sins. His statement, we will carry, is in the form of an order, but what is intended by it is to inform only. The benefit of that being to place something which is being informed at the status of something imposed and binding.
The author, rahimahullah, he now goes into the second type of taqseemul kalam, dividing and categorizing speech. We've just taken the first type, which is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يتركب منه. What's the bare minimum that we can consider speech? We've taken that. We're now going to go into the second type, which is تقسيم الكلام, dividing the speech باعتبار مدلوله, what it indicates. And the author, رحمه الله, he divides it into two, الخبر and الإنشاء. And we'll take what they mean, inshallah ta'ala. The author said, الخبر is ما يمكن أن يوصف بالصدق أو الكذب لذاته. Now, this definition that the author gave, it's not a good definition. مع جلالة الشيخ, with the honor and the respect that we have for the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih Uthaymeen, his definition here for al-khabar is not muhaqqaq, it wasn't accurate, it's not accurate. The best definition to give is the definition that was chosen by Ibn Shaat al-Maliki rahimahullah. Ibn Shaat al-Maliki's definition is the best. And the definition that Ibn Shaat al-Maliki gave is ما يلزم الصدق أو الكذب. ما يلزم الصدق أو الكذب. ما يلزم الصدق أو الكذب. What does that mean? So the best definition is the definition given by Ibn Shaat al-Maliki, which is ما يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب. خبر is either it has to be a lie or it has to be truthful. It's something that we can say it's truthful or it has to become a lie. One of the two. Are we all together? The statement of the Shaykh's one, it's problematic. The reason why it's problematic, and he was forced because of his definition to add the word lidati in there, which he didn't even have to bring aslan. He didn't have to bring the word lidati, which is, they say khabar is anything you can say to a person, you're lying or you're telling the truth. That's what they say. But then that means, what about the news Allah tells you? Can you say, Allah, you're lying? Are we all together? Does that make sense? We just said khabar is news. And a news is anything you can say, it's true or it's not. So does that mean that we can say to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and His Messenger that you're not telling the truth? Because if we can't, if that is not there, then that can't be considered a speech. It's not a speech. It has to be able to be said true or not. Are we all together? Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, because of that, he knows that somebody can say that, he added the word lidati in there. And through the lidati, he mentions that he's trying to take out depending on who's saying it. What is even better than that is ما يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب, which means it has to be either one of the two. It's not the possibility of being any one of them. It's either truthful or it's a lie. Are we all together? That's the best definition, and that's what we're going to stick with, that Ibn Shaat al-Maliki rahimahullah mentioned. A lot of the discussion that takes place is that. Insha, on the other hand, what is it? Insha is, in simple terms, it is the opposite of al-khabar. What is it? It's the total opposite. It is anything you can't say to the person you're lying, or you can't say to the person you're telling the truth. Neither of the two. Are we all together? There's two differences between the khabar and the insha. How many differences are between the two of them? There are two differences. The first difference is the khabar is something that's already happened, and when you're talking about it, it took place. Are we all together? Whereas the insha, no. It hasn't happened. Does that make sense? The insha hasn't happened yet. Whereas the khabar has already happened. That's the first difference. The second difference is that the khabar, it follows what you're talking about. But the insha is the thing that's followed. The khabar, it follows the thing that's been spoken about. Whereas the insha, it follows. Are we all together? Or the Isha is followed. The Khabar, it follows. Regarding what you're talking about. Are we all together? It's following up a thing that has happened or something that's taken place. So it follows it up, the Khabar. Whereas the Insha is something that's followed. It'll make sense, inshallah ta'ala, when we give an example. Insha, it comes in many forms, and there are 8 forms that we're going to mention, inshallah ta'ala. How many forms are we going to mention for the Insha? We're going to mention that the Insha comes in forms. Forms. Are you with me? The first form of Insha is Al-Amru, commandment. Are we all together? Commandment. What is it? A commandment. The second one is Al-Nahi, prohibition. The third one is Istifham, interrogation. 4, Taraji, hope. Tamanni, wishful thinking. 6, An-Nida, calling out, proclaim. 7, in the form of a khabar intended as an insha. In the form of a khabar, but what is intended from it is insha. لِفَائِدَةٍ بَلَاغِيَّةٍ, because of a eloquent reason. Number 8 is, it comes in the form of a insha, but is actually intended as a khabar. Let's give an example for each one, inshallah ta'ala. Number 1, Al-Amru, the commandment. Like the statement of Allah, وَبَتَلُوا الْيَتَامَى, test the orphans. Before you give them the wealth of their father, test them. وَبَتَلُوا الْيَتَامَى, test them. That is an insha. You can't say that's a lie or true. You can't say that's a commandment. And now your prohibition. The statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Bukhari and Muslim, لا يمسكن أحدكم ذكره بيمينه وهو يبول. One should do not hold your private part with your right hand whilst you're urinating. Number 3, استفهام, question. It's a question. أليس إذا حاضت لم تصلي ولم تصم. Isn't the woman, when she's on her menses, she does not pray nor does she fast? Number 4, التَّرَجِّي. تَرَجِّي means hope. Like when Allah was talking about حَاكِيَةً عَنْ مُوسَى, when Allah was talking about Nabi Allah Musa, when he said, لَعَلِّي آتِيكُم مِّنْهَا بِقَبَسٍ بِخَبَرٍ أَوْ جَدْوَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَصْطَلُونَ. When he said, لَعَلِّي آتِيكُم مِّنْهَا بِخَبَرٍ أَوْ جَدْوَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَصْطَلُونَ. Surah Al-Qasas. لَعَلِّي I may come to you with a news, or I might come with a fire with my stick. And the 5th one is At-Tamanni. Tamanni is the statement of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, أَوْ تَقُولَ حِينَ تَرَى الْعَذَابَ لَوْ أَنَّ لِي بِي أَوْ لَوْ أَنَّ لِي كَرَّةً فَأَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. When they see the hellfire, أَوْ تَقُولَ حِينَ تَرَى الْعَذَابَ, when they see the hellfire, what do they say? لَوْ أَنَّ لِي كَرَّةً, أي الرجوع, if I only have the chance to go back. Okay, فَأَكُونَ, so I can be from the muhsineen and the upright ones, the righteous slaves of us. What is the difference between التمني and تَرَجِّي? The difference between them is التَرَجِّي هو طلب ما لا يمكن التمني, sorry. It is تمني. تمني means what? هو طلب ما لا يمكن حصوله. You're asking for the impossible or the improbable. Okay, it's something that is impossible, it won't happen. Like what they said, أو تقول حين ترى العذاب لو أن لي كرة فأكون من المحسنين. If I can only have a second chance and go back to the earth, that's تمني. It's not going to happen. Wishful thinking. Second one is التَّرَجِّي, which is طلب ما يمكن حصوله بلا عسر. It's something that can happen without any hardship. Tamanni can happen sometimes, but that's why I said improbable. It happens, but it's hard for it to happen. The sixth one is al-nida, calling out. When Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nasu ubudu rabbakum, that's al-nida. Oh, people, worship Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. The seventh one is it comes in the form of an insha, but it's not intended as an insha. It's actually intended as a khabar. Sorry. It comes in the form of a khabar, but what is intended from it is al-insha. Al-insha. And this is a lifa'idatin balaghiyya. I'm going to mention the benefit in that. And the example for that is wal-mutallaqatu yatarabbasna. Wal-mutallaqatu yatarabbasna bi-anfusihinna thalathata quru'. Let's read what the ayah says. وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ The divorced women. يَتَرَبَّصْنَ means they are waiting. What are they waiting for? ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءَ They are waiting for three period. Whether it's three حيض or three طُهْرٍ is discussion amongst the ulama. Okay? And if you want the best answer, go to Sheikh Muhammad Al-Amin Al-Shanqiti's Tafsir Al-Adwa' Al-Bayan. He gives the best answer. Best answer, he's done a thorough and a good research on that. Anyways, yatarabbasna here is a what? It's a khabar. So what did Allah say? They are waiting. They are waiting is a khabar. Yuradu biha al-amr. But what is intended from it here is al-amr. Are we all together? Meaning, they should wait. Are we all together? It's like when your parent says to you, You sit here as a command. You're going to wait with me. Are we all together? The khabar. Are we all together? Lakin it's amr. It's a what? Amr. Why would Allah do it in suratul khabar? But the intent is I insha. Why? What's the benefit? The benefit here is تأكيد المأمور به حتى كأن واقع يتحدث عنه وذلك أبلغ من مجرد الأمر. It's talking about it like it's happening. The way that something, when it happens, it takes place. This commandment is going to take place like that. It's not just do it and it's a commandment like that, but it's actually solidifying even more to the extent like it, take like something that's happening, which is talking about it like it's something that's taking place right now, and that's a stronger commandment. Are we all together? Same is with the ayah wal walidati yurdi'na awladahunna hawlayn kamilayn. Yurdi'na, say suratul khabar, like al-insha is intended. Also qad qamat as-salah. قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ means what? قُومُوا لِلصَّلَاةِ Stand up for the prayer. It's an amr. But it is in the form of what? It's in the form of a khabar. But it's in sha'. It's an amr that's intended here. Also the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, صَلَاةُ اللَّيْلِ مَثْنَا مَثْنَا The night prayer is 2-2-2. فَإِنْ خَشِي أَحَدُكُمْ فَإِذَا خَشِي أَحَدُكُمْ If one of you is scared, إِذَا خَشِي أَحَدُكُمْ الصُّبْحَ If one of you is scared of the fajr to come in, صَلَّى رَكْعَةً He prays one rak'a, وَاحِدَةً One rak'a, تُوْتَرُ لَهُ مَا قَدْ صَلَّى تُوْتَرُ is a khabar. It's a khabar. But what does it mean here? لِيُصَلِّ رَكْعَةً وَاحِدَةً He needs to pray one rak'a. Allah is talking about it. It's like the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is saying it like, and he is going to do his witr. No, it means do your witr. The eighth is, it comes in the form of an insha. But what is intended from it is a khabar. It's the opposite. Such as what Allah said in the ayah, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا The disbelievers, they said to the لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا The believers. The disbelievers are speaking to the believers. What did they say to them? اتَّبِعُوا سَبِيلَنَا Follow our paths. وَلْنَحْمِلْ خَطَايَاكُمْ We are taking your sins for you. We will take your sins for you. Yeah? Ama. وَلْنَحْمِلْ خَطَايَاكُمْ We are command you to take your sins for you, basically. So it's in the form of a command, but they mean a khabar from it. What's the fa'ida here? They are trying to do what is known as tanzilul mukhbari anhu manzilat al ma'mur bihi alladhi yalzamu al-ityan bihi. The same way that is obligatory for the amr, what does it show? Obligation, right? It's obligatory. We promise you, it's obligatory. We made it obligatory on ourselves to come and take your sins for you. We will take your sins for you. We will handle your sins for you. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He refuted them by saying to them, وَمَا هُمْ بِحَامِلِينَ مِنْ خَطَايَاهُمْ. They are not ones to carry anyone's burdens. Who can take somebody's burdens? And the ayah to show you that this actually is a khabar, Sa'ad. To show that وَلْنَحْمِلْ خَطَايَاكُمْ here, that it means khabar, is at the ending. What did Allah say at the ending of the ayah? إِنَّهُمْ لَكَاذِبُونَ. They are liars. The ending of the ayah. So what does that show? Here that it's a khabar. There's another one that needs to be pointed out, which is a speech sometimes can be a khabar from one angle, khabaran bi'tibarin, insha'an bi'tibarin akhar. From one angle it's a khabar, and from another angle it's an insha'. For example, all of the siyaghul uqud and all of the siyaghul fusukh, all of the forms of buying and selling. When you say to somebody, bi'tuka wa qabiltu, I have sold to you, I have accepted from you, ankahtuka, and things like that. I mean, ankahtuka. All of these, in terms of its wording, it's a khabar. And in terms of its meaning, is an insha. As Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, he says in his Bayanu al-Dalil ala Butlan al-Tahlil, page 170. He says, rahimahullah ta'ala, siyaghu al-uqud qad qila, hiya insha'at. وقيل إخبارات وهي في الحقيقة إخبارات عن المعاني التي في القلب وتلك المعاني إنشاءات فاللفظ خبر والمعنى إنشاء. The wording is a خبر and the meaning is إنشاء. The same is صيغ الفسوخ. When a man wants to separate from his wife, for example, when he said أقلت أما طلقت أما خلعت, whatever it may be, all the types of separation from the spouse, also they are the same. They are a lafdu khabar, the wording is a khabar, and the meaning is a, it's a insha. It's a insha. As for the siyagul fi'liya, like bay'ul mu'atat, any action-based tradings and buying and things like that, then you can't call it a khabar or an insha, because khabar and insha is connected to kalam, speech. It's connected to wordings. So they don't have no places for it. Okay? They don't have no places for it. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, al-haqiqatu wal-majaz. وينقسم الكلام من حيث الاستعمال إلى حقيقة ومجاز. فالحقيقة هي اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له مثل أسد للحيوان المفترس. فخرج بقولنا المستعمل المهمل. فلا يسمى حقيقة ولا مجازا. وخرج بقولنا فيما وضع له المجاز. وتنقسم الحقيقة إلى ثلاثة أقسام. لغوية وشرعية وعرفية. فاللغوية هي اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له في اللغة. فخرج بقولنا في اللغة الحقيقة الشرعية والعرفية. مثال ذلك الصلاة، فإن حقيقتها اللغوية الدعاء، فتحمل عليه في كلام أهل اللغة. والحقيقة الشرعية هي اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له في الشرع. فخرج بقولنا في الشرع الحقيقة اللغوية والعرفية. مثال ذلك الصلاة، فإن حقيقتها الشرعية الأقوال والأفعال المعلومة المفتتحة بالتكبير المختتمة بالتسليم، فتحمل في كلام أهل الشرع على ذلك. والحقيقة العرفية هي اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له في العرف. والحقيقة العرفية هي اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له في العرف. فخرج بقولنا في العرف الحقيقة اللغوية والشرعية. مثال ذلك الدابة، فإن حقيقتها العرفية ذات الأربع من الحيوان، فتحمل عليه في كلام أهل العرف. وفائدة معرفة تقسيم الحقيقة إلى ثلاثة أقسام، أن نحمل كل لفظ على معناه الحقيقي في موضع استعماله، فيحمل في استعمال أهل اللغة على الحقيقة اللغوية، وفي استعمال الشرع على الحقيقة الشرعية وفي استعمال أهل العرف على الحقيقة العرفية. والمجاز هو اللفظ المستعمل في غير ما وضع له مثل أسد للرجل الشجاع، فخرج بقولنا المستعمل المهمل فلا يسمى حقيقة ولا مجازا، وخرج بقولنا في غير ما وضع له الحقيقة، ولا يجوز حمل اللفظ على مجاز إلا بدليل صحيح يمنع من إرادة الحقيقة، وهو ما يسمى في علم البيان بالقرينة. ويشترط لصحة استعمال اللفظ في مجازه وجود ارتباط بين المعنى الحقيقي والمجازي ليصح التعبير به عنه، وهو ما يسمى في علم البيان بالعلاقة، وهو ما يسمى في علم البيان بالعلاقة. والعلاقة إما أن تكون المشابهة أو غيرها، فإن كانت المشابهة سمي التجوز استعارة، كالتجوز بلفظ أسد عن الرجل الشجاع، وإن كانت غير المشابهة سمي التجوز مجازا مرسلا إن كان التجوز في الكلمات، ومجازا عقليا إن كان التجوز في الإسناد. مثال في المجاز المرسل أن تقول رعينا المطر، فكلمة المطر مجاز عن الشعب، فالتجوز بالكلمة. ومثال ذلك في المجاز العقلي أن تقول أنبت المطر الشعب، مثال ذلك في المجاز المرسل أن تقول رعينا المطر، فكلمة المطر مجاز عن العشب، رعينا المطر فكلمة المطر مجاز عن العشب، فالتجوز بالكلمة. ومثال ذلك في المجاز العقلي أن تقول أنبت المطر العشب، فالكلمات كلها يراد بها حقيقة معناها، لكن إسناد الإنبات إلى المطر مجاز، لأن المنبت حقيقة هو الله تعالى، فالتجوز في الإسناد. ومن المجاز المرسل التجوز بالزيادة والتجوز بالحذف. مثل للمجاز بالزيادة بقوله تعالى ليس كمثله شيء، فقالوا إن الكاف زائدة لتأكيد نفي المثل عن الله تعالى. ومثال المجاز بالحذف قوله تعالى واسأل القرية، أي واسأل أهل القرية، فحذفت أهل مجازا. وللمجاز أنواع كثيرة مذكورة في علم البيان، وإنما ذكر طرف من الحقيقة والمجاز في أصول الفقه لأن دلالة الألفاظ إما حقيقة وإما مجاز، فاحتيج إلى معرفة كل منهما وحكمه، والله أعلم.
Truth and metaphor. Speech is divided in terms of usage to reality and metaphor. Number one, reality is the word used for the meaning it has been placed for, such as a lion for a predatory animal. So what is excluded from our statement used for is something neglected. This is not called reality or a metaphor. And what is also excluded from our statement placed for is the metaphor. Reality is divided into three sections: linguistic, legal in the Sharia, and customary. Linguistically refers to a word used for the meaning it has been given in the language. And what is excluded from our word linguistically is the legal and customary. For example, the prayer, salah, linguistically means supplication. So that is the meaning the people of the language gave it. It is legal. Its legal reality is the meaning given to it by the Sharia. So what is excluded from our statement by the Sharia is customary or linguistic reality. An example of that is the prayer. Its legal reality is words and deeds that begin with takbir, opening act, and end with the taslim, closing act. So this is what the people of the legislation place on this word. The customary reality is a word used for the meaning placed on it by the customs of people. So what is excluded from our statement, custom, is a linguistic and legislative reality. For example, a daba, its reality in the traditional sense is that of a four-legged animal. So that is the meaning that it carries in the custom of the people. And the benefit of knowing this fact, that the reality of words is divided into three types, is that we hold each word to its correct meaning in the way it is used. So in the use of the linguistics and in its linguistic reality, and in the legislation and its legislative reality, and in the use of the traditionalist on its traditional reality. Number two, the metaphor is a word used for other than the purpose it was intended. For example, a lion for a brave man. So what is excluded from our statement used are unused words, which is neither a reality nor a metaphor. And what is not included by the words for other than the purpose it was intended is reality. It is not permissible to load a word intending its metaphoric meaning except with a correct proof that prevents the realistic meaning being intended. And it is known in the field of eloquence as qarina. The condition of using a word for its metaphorical meaning is the presence of a link between the realistic meaning and the metaphorical meaning. So the expression is correct, and this is known in the knowledge of bayan, eloquence, as a link. And it is either through similarity or otherwise. So if it is a similarity, then it is called a tajawwuz, isti'ara, borrowing, as is the case with the word lion for a brave man. And if it is not similar, then it is called a tajawwuz majaz mursal, metonym. If the tajawwuz is in the words and psychological metaphor, if it is in the attribution. An example of a metonym is to say we took care of the rain, meaning the pasture. So this is an example of a tajawwuz in the word. An instance of a psychological metaphor is to say the rain has given growth to the pastures. So the meaning of the words in real terms is what is meant, but to attribute the growth to the rain is metaphorical in use, because the one who really causes growth is Allah, so it is tajawwuz in attribution. Also from the use of metonyms in addition and omission, an example of which is the statement of Allah the Most High, there is none the like of Him. It is said that the letter Kaf is extra for the purpose of highlighting the negation of anything like unto Allah the Most High. An example of a metaphor by omission is the verse, ask the village, i.e. ask the people of the village, so the word people is omitted for metaphoric purpose. And there are numerous types of such metaphorical instances that are listed in the sciences of bayan, eloquence. Here, only some of the types of reality and metaphor in usul al-fiqh have been mentioned due to the fact that the meaning of words is either real or metaphorical. So the need arose to make each one known and the ruling, and Allah knows best.
The author, rahimahullah, he now goes into the third type of categorization of speech. The author, rahimahullah, he now goes into the third type of categorization of speech. And that is speech بِعْتِبَارِ اِسْتِعْمَالِهِ, speech in terms of its usage. That's the third type of categorization. We're going to divide the speech into حَقِيقَ and majaz, which means literal and metaphorical. حَقِيقَ means it's literal. It is, and we're going to translate that more. And the second one, which is al-majaz. Al-majaz, which is metaphor. So in terms of the usage of the word, those are the two that they divide it into. What does haqiqa mean? The author, rahimahullah, he explained it to mean haqiqa is al-lafzu al-musta'malu fi ma wudi'a lahu. It is al-lafzu. When we say al-lafzu, what do we get rid of? We get rid of actions. Haqiqa al-majaz does not speak about, it does not discuss actions. But when you say al-lafzu, majaz is in there and haqiqa is in there. Majaz is metaphor and haqiqa is literal. Both of them are in the word al-lafzu. But actions are not in there. An action you cannot call a haqiqa or a majaz. Second is al-musta'amilu. Al-musta'amilu is that the word that's used. So what are we getting rid of? That which is not used. The third one is فِيمَا وُضِعَ لَهُ, for what it was placed for what the word was originally used as, what it really means. فِيمَا وُضِعَ لَهُ, that's what it means. What gets out of the definition here? The majaz does. Because the majaz is using a word for what it wasn't placed for. Whereas haqiqa is using the word for what it was placed for. Example, a lion is placed as al-haywan al-muftaris. a predatory animal. That's what the lion, the word asad means. That's its haqiqi meaning. So we're using it in its haq. Ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. That's what it means. That is a haqiqi meaning. What about ghaid? Ghaid is used for ala al-ard al-munkhafid. Al-munkhafidu min al-ardi. The ghaid, in its literal meaning, it means the earth that's down. The earth that is a bit down, deep, or a bit down. Da'ina, for example, the word da'ina. Da'ina is used in its haqiqi meaning on the camel that the woman rides on. Salah is what? In its rich literal meaning, according to the ibadah which is known. That's all the haqiqi usage of these words. The haqiqi bil istiqra, after deduction, the scholars have reached the conclusion that it is three types. Induction, the scholars, they reach it three types. After tatabbu' and istiqra, following the textual evidence, they realize it's three types. Haqiqa lughawiyya, haqiqa shar'iyya, and haqiqa urfiyya. The author mentioned all three of them. Haqiqa lughawiyya is al-lafdhu al-musta'milu fi ma wudi'a lahu fi al-lugha. It is the word that is used in what it was placed in the Arabic language. Those three points. Al-lafdhu al-musta'milu fi ma wudi'a lahu fi al-lugha. As it was placed in the Arabic language. We already know what al-lafdhu means. We know what al-musta'malu means. Fi ma wudi'a lahu, we know what it means. Lakin fi al-lughati here. All of that was a definition of haqiqa. Haqiqa is what? Al-lafdhu al-musta'malu fi ma wudi'a lahu. Fi al-lughati, just add that onto it. So we just have to define what it means fi al-lughati. Fi al-lughati means in the Arabic language. The Arabs use this word, but it's a meaning for them. Like for example, the word al-istinja in the Arabic language, it means al-qat'u, to cut something. It's to remove something. Zaka in the Arabic language, it means al-nama. It's to cultivate something. And it's to increase something. And al-ziyada. Fasting in the Arabic language, it means al-imsaku, to withhold. Hajj in the Arabic language means al-qasdu, to intend. Al-bay'u in the Arabic language, it means al-mubadala, to exchange. Nikah in the Arabic language means al-dammu wal-jam'u, to come together. Okay? All of that is the Arabic language. You're using those words in the Arabic language. That's haqiqah lughawiyya, linguistic usage. The second type is the lexical usage. The second one is haqiqah shar'iyya. It means al-lafdhu al-musta'milu fima wudi'a lahu fi shar'i. The word is being used in the sharia. When you say fi shar'i, you get rid of lughawiyya and you get rid of urfiyya. It means, for example, the same word, al-istinja. What is it used in the sharia? It means izalatul al-khariju min al-sabilayni. It is to get rid of and to remove what comes from the front and the back with water or with stone or anything like that. Salah means what? It means al-aqwal wal-af'al al-muftatahatu bit-takbiri al-mukhtatamatu bit-taslimi. Salah means speech and actions that you open with Allahu Akbar and you finish with Assalamu Alaikum. Zakah is what? Al-haqq al-maliyu al-makhsusu li-ta'ifati al-makhsusati fi zaman al-makhsus. It is financial rights that are specific to a group of people at a period of time. Okay? That's zakah in the sharia. Okay? And other things like that. That's called haqiqa shar'iyya. The third one is haqiqa urfiyya. It is custom-based definition. But the reality here is you're defining it based on the custom. Al-lafdhu al-musta'milu fi ma wudi'a lahu fi al-urfi. It's placed in the urf. Like for example, ad-dabba. The author gave the example of the word ad-dabba. The word dabba, where is it used in the urf? The custom of the people is used as fi dhati al-arba'i min al-haywani. The animal, four-legged beast. Even though in the Arabic language it's used as what? It's used ala kullu ma yadibbu ala al-ardi. Anything that walks on this earth, even the humans will fall under that. Like in the urf, the custom, the word dabba, when you hear it, you know it's what? It's a four-legged animal. Okay? Like in the language, they don't use it like that. They use it as ala kulli ma yadibbu ala al-ardi, anything that walks on this earth. Humans will fall under that. Wal ghaitu, the ghait is considered what? In the urf. It's considered as, in the urf, the filth that comes out of the person. They call that ghaid. Da'ina, what do they consider in the Arabic language? The word da'ina that we took. They consider the woman who's on the right and on the camel. So they call the word da'ina, the woman who's on the camel. But in the language it was called what? The camel that the woman is on. So these are the urfi usage. The Shaykh mentioned something very powerful, which is fa'idatu taqseem al-haqiqah ila hadhihi al-aqsam al-thalatha. What benefit does it hold categorizing the haqiqah into these three? What benefit does it hold? The author, rahimahullah, he said, the benefit that it holds is an nahmila kulla lafdhin. Every word, we're going to carry it. We're going to explain it. Ala ma'anahu al-haqiqi, in the right meaning that it holds. Okay? So for example, if it's used by the people of the language, we would define it based on the haqiqah al-lughawiyah. And if it's used by the people of the sharia, we would define it based on the haqiqah shar'iyah. And if it's used by the people ahlul urfi, the people and the customs, then we're going to take it to al-haqiqatul urfiya, on the traditional meaning. That's what we're going to do. For example, the word tawadda'u mimma massatil nar. Tawadda'u mimma massatil nar. Do wudu from whatever touched fire. Okay? Here's a side benefit. As a side benefit, there are some people who say you don't have to do wudu from a camel. Because they argue and they say, the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith, he says, تَوَضَّأُوا دُو وُضُوءٍ مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ, that which the fire touched. If anything has been burnt on the fire, it's been cooked on the fire, then do wudu from it. Okay? Jabir then radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, the last of the two affairs was not to do wudu from whatever touches the fire. So it seems like whatever was said before the statement of Jabir is abrogated. Are we all together, brothers? Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, the last, kana akhirul amrayni, the last of the two affairs was that you don't have to do wudu from whatever touches fire. So this is an indication that the previous ruling was abrogated. Then the Prophet in another hadith, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions to do wudu from the camel meat. Okay? So they said that that's abrogated. They say that is abrogated. And then Imam al-Nawawi came back and he responded to this and he said that argument is very weak. Because tawadda'u mimma massatil nar, do from whatever touches the fire, was a general ruling. Okay? Are we all together? It's a general ruling. Tawadda'u mimma massatil nar. Then an exception came. Sorry, tawadda'u mimma massatil nar came. And then another hadith came, which is, you don't have to do wudu. The last of the affairs was, don't do wudu from whatever touches fire. The scholars, they said, this last hadith of Jabir, where it says, don't do wudu from whatever touches fire, and that was the last of the affairs, is a general ruling. It's a what? It's a general ruling. And the hadith that says to do wudu from the camel meat is a specific ruling. And they said, يُقَدَّمُ الْخَاسُ عَلَى الْعَامِ. If the Am and the Khas go against each other, what do? You give precedence to the specific over the general. Because we have to find a way to bring the textual evidences all together. وَالْجَمْعُ وَاجِبٌ مَتَى مَا أَمْكَنَا. We have to try to bring the text together and not dismiss one over the other. So Nawawi says that the other hadith means anything other than the camel, you don't have to do wudu for him, inshaAllah ta'ala. Because that's a specific one. That's the only one that's remaining from the hadith of tawadda'u mimma massatil nar. The only one that's remaining from there is what? The camel meat. Anything other than the camel meat, you don't have to do wudu from. You don't have to. That's a side benefit and a side point. That's a side point. Like in this hadith says, tawadda'u, do wudu mimma massatil nar. The word wudu in the Arabic language, it means al-nadafa. Are we all together? Al-nadafa. So when we say tawadda'u mimma massat an-nar, does it mean just wash your mouth and your hands and that's it, khalas? Based on that hadith, tawadda'u mimma massat an-nar. Or does it mean do the wudu shar'i? Because here we have a reality which is lughawiyyah, and we have a haqiqi shar'iyyah here. Which one do we give consideration to? Because it was said by the sharia and the legislator, we have to use which one? Haqiqa shar'iyyah. That's what we just took as a benefit right now. Because it was used by the legislator, because it was used in the Quran and the Sunnah, we have to take it on what? Al-haqiqa al-shar'iyyah. So here we're going to say that this wudu, it's the wudu shar'i. Not mujarrad al-nadafa, not just a mere cleaning. But if a statement is said by the Arabs, for example, is given precedence to that meaning. Here's a benefit that we need to take. The sharih of the kitab Al-Usul min Al-Musul, he mentioned, he said, وَكَذَا مَا جَاءَ فِي خِطَابِ الْعَرَبِي وَأَشْعَارِهِمْ وَأَمْثَالِهِمْ يُحْمَلُ عَلَى الْحَقِيقَةِ اللُّغَوِيَّةِ. If it comes in the Arab poets, the poetry of the Arabs, if it comes in their proverbs, then we will take it based on the Arabic language. We'll say this is haqiqa lughawiyya because the Arabs said it, because the people of the language said this. And whatever is famous عند العربي to the Arabs, إطلاقه على معنى معين. This word became famous for the Arabs to use it in this way. وهجرت فيه الحقيقة اللغوية. But, pay attention, it's a very important point. If there's a word that the Arabs used it for a particular meaning, and the Arabs coined a meaning for it, but that meaning got boycotted, it got left, dismissed, it's no longer used anymore, no one uses it in that way anymore. Guess what we do then? We will use the haqiqa al-urfiyya, because the haqiqa al-lughawiyya is mahjur. It's boycotted, it's left. We're going to now use the haqiqa al-urfiyya. We're going to use the haqiqa al-urfiyya. So let me say that one more time. If the statement comes from the shari'ah, okay, the legislator, it comes from Allah or His Messenger, تقدم الحقيقة الشرعية. Which one do you give precedence to? حقيقة الشرعية and then the حقيقة اللغوية. Sorry, حقيقة العرفية. So this is, if it comes in the Sharia, we give this order. What is the order? تقدم الحقيقة الشرعية. We give the Sharia precedence and we give that first. Then we give الحقيقة العرفية. We give the حقيقة of the urf, the customs, al-mawjuda fi zaman al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the time of the Prophet. The zaman, sahabas, their urf, we use that. Then we use thumma haqiqatul lughawiyya. Then we give, we already gave you an example of taqdeemul haqiqatul shari'a ala lughawiyya, sah? Giving precedence to what? The sharia over the what? The language. Now I have to give you an example of giving precedence to al-haqiqatu al-urfiyya over the language. Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, sadaqatul fitri. Kunna nu'tiha fi zaman al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sa'an min ta'amin. At the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we used to give a sa'. This is an amount. Okay? Sa'an min ta'amin. We used to give a sa' of ta'am. And sa'an min sha'irin. Sha'ir is what? It is barley. Or sa'an min aqitin is dry yogurt or cheese, if you want to call it. Or sa'an min zabibin. Zabibin is raisin. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, this is what we used to give a sadaqah. The word here that's been used, which is sa'an min ta'amin. What does the word ta'am mean? According to the urf of the sahabas, they used to call al-ta'am as al-bur, the wheat. So now, we're going to give that precedence over the linguistic meaning, because the linguistic meaning for ta'am is every food. Now we're going to say, تقديم الحقيقة العرفية الموجودة في زمان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Precedence is given to الحقيقة العرفية that was present at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then after that comes الحقيقة اللغوية. Okay? At the time of the Salaf, the word al-ta'amu meant al-bur, wheat. So that's what we do. So we said that this is the reality of it. What about the speech of the human beings, not the legislator? We said the legislator is which order? حقيقة شرعية. Then we said the حقيقة عرفية الموجودة that was present في زمان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the حقيقة اللغوية. That's in the statement of the Sharia. If you find anything in the Quran or the Sunnah, that's the order you go. What about the speeches of the human beings? The speeches of كلام الآدميين, the speech of the humans. لكن الذي يترتب عليه حكم شرعي. But there comes from it a شرعي ruling comes out of their speech. Okay? It's not any speech. We're talking about the speech that will have a شرعي implication. And I'll give you an example, inshallah ta'ala. Then the order is as follows. We give precedence to الحقيقة الشرعية first. And then we give حقيقة اللغوية. So we give the شرعي. And then we give لغوي, linguistic. And then we give the عرفي, the custom. Why was the urf here given delayed and the lugha was put forward? Why did one go over the other? Because the scholars, they said, the reason is because لِأَنَّهُ لَا يَنْضَبِطُ. Because the customs after the Sahabas is hard to restrict it to what because there's too many customs. ولذلك الفقهاء they say ما ليس له ضابط في الشرع ولا في اللغة يرجع فيه إلى العرف. That which doesn't have a ضابط in the Sharia, there's no way to restrict it, there's no way to narrow it down in the Sharia. ولا في اللغة, and not in the language. يرجع فيه إلى العرف. Then you try to look for the customs. The custom comes after. Okay. لكن when it comes to the حقيق, when it comes to the كلام الشارع, no, حقيقة شرعية, حقيقة عرفية, and then حقيقة لغوية. Some of the فقهاء, they came back and they said, إن هجرت الحقيقة اللغوية. Pay attention now. The Arabic language was boycotted. Which one comes first in the speech of this human being? حقيقة لغوية comes before the حقيقة عرفية, right? لكن this حقيقة لغوية is boycotted. It's actually abandoned. Nobody uses it. It's left. وصارت, and it became نسيا منسيا. It became something that was abandoned and forgotten. قدم العرف, the عرف will be given custom over it. وإن كانت, even if تستعمل أحيانا, even if it's sometimes used, قدمت, it will still be given precedence لأنها الأصل, because it's الأصل. For example, a man made a halaf. He made a cop oath. لا يركب دابة. He said, I promise I am never going to take a dabba. I am never going to take a dabba. فحمله ولده. His child and his son takes him and he carries his father after he becomes tired. This man goes, wallahi, I'm going to go to the house of Allah. Wallahi, I'm going to do tawaf around the Kaaba. And wallahi, I'm not going to move. I'm not going to ride on a dabba. I'm not going to climb a dabba. I promise I will not go on a dabba. After circumambulation around the Kaaba, he got tired. So his son grabbed him, put him on his shoulder, and he ran around the Kaaba with him. Now, this is a kalam of a human being, and it has a shari'i implication here. What do we do here? Because he used the word dabba. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَنْحَثُ. This man, we won't tell him to bring back kafara. There's no expiation on him. Why? لِأَنَّ الْحَقِيقَةُ اللُّغَوِيَّةِ. The linguistic usage was what? Anything. The linguistic usage was وهو كل ما يدب على الأرض, anything that walks on the earth. So the sun would have been a dab. So he lied by saying that. So he has to be a kafara. But the Arabic language is what? It's مهجورة منسية. It's not used anymore. It's boycotted. No one even knows that that's what it means. If you ask an Arab today, dabba, if you look at the Arabs, they will just say dabba is a riding beast. No one uses dabba as anything that walks on this earth. Okay? No one uses that. So here, qa'ida is, in hujiratil haqiqatul lughawiyya, if the linguistic usage is boycotted, and it becomes nasyan mansiyan, something that's forgotten and abandoned, is given precedence over the customs in the speech of the human beings. Are we all together? That's important. The second type, now we finished haqiqa. We finished haqiqa. We've finished haqiqa. What did we speak about when we spoke about haqiqa? We spoke about the definition of haqiqa. We said it is اللفظ المستعمل فيما وضع له. And we said it's three types. في اللغة, في الشرعي and في العرفي. And then we said that the benefit of learning this, what's the benefit of learning it? That when the statement comes from the legislator, you take it based on the حقيقي اللغة, شرعي usage. And if it comes from أهل اللغة, you take it based on حقيقة اللغوية. And if it comes from أهل العرف, you take it based on حقيقة العرفية. Good. And we gave examples for each one. Then we spoke about what is known as ترتيب الحقائق. What is the sequence of these حقيقات? There are three. Which one comes first? Which one comes second? Which comes third? We said it's based on two. If it comes from الشارع, Allah and His Messenger, then it is حقيقة شرعية, حقيقة عرفية التي. The عرفية here is what? الموجودة في زمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then the لغوية. The حقيقة الشرعية comes first. And then the custom that was present at the time of the noble Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the third one, which is the حقيقة اللغوية. But if it's the statement, if it's a statement of the human being and it has a حكم شرعي implication to it, then the order is حقيقة شرعية, then حقيقة لغوية, and then حقيقة عرفية. لكن it can happen that the عرفية gets put before the لغوية if the لغوية is نسيا منسيا, if it's مهجور, if it's what? If it's boycotted and if it's left. Now we're going to move on to the next type of speech بإعتبار استعمالي in terms of its usage. And that is المجاز. مجاز is metaphor. Okay? And it's a مصدر ميمي. And it comes from the word العبور. العبور is to cross something. Meaning the meaning that was in this word has now crossed onto this. That's why it's called المجاز. According to the definition that Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen gave is اللَّفْظُ الْمُسْتَعْمِلُ, it is the word that's being used فِي غَيْرِ مَا وُضِعَ لَهُ, in other than what it was placed for. Example, the word lion is being used for a brave man. That's not what the word was for. Asad was originally for what? الْحَيْوَانُ الْمُفْتَرِسِ, the predatory animal. But now it's being used here for a brave man. The second one is بحر, water. Water is, the haqiqa is that it's, bahar is an ocean and it's the water. But it's being used here for what? Alal alimi, the scholar, the knowledgeable person. Shams, sun. If it's used in the context of what? Al fatatul jamila, the beautiful girl. As Ibn al Amid said in his lines of poetry, he said, قامت تضللني, قامت, she stood up, تضللني, she was shading me. من الشمس, from the sun. نفس أحب إلي من نفسي, a soul that is more beloved to me than my own soul. قامت, she stood up. تضللني, she's shading me. ومن عجبي, what is amazing is شمس, a sun. تضللني, that is shading me. من الشمس, from the sun. So he used the word shams at the ending. قامت تضللني ومن عجب شمس تضللني من الشمس. He used the word شمس twice. The first شمس that he means is the girl. He's referring to her beauty. She's shading me from this actual sun. So he's used her as a sun. So, but the word شمس is not used for, in its haqiqi meaning, it's not used for a woman, a beautiful woman. It's used for what? It is used for the sun, actual sun. So, this is now called majaz, لأنه ترك فيها المعنى الحقيقي. The literal meaning was left, وعبير بها إلى معنى آخر. And they bridged to, عبير. What did they do? They bridged to, they moved to a new meaning. Here's a benefit that I want you to, and many people don't know this. What's the difference between al-majaz and the haqiqa urfiya? Pay attention here. They resemble each other from a particular angle, which is both of them have been used for other than what it was placed for, if you look at it. Okay? Both of them, the haqiqa urfiya and the majaz, both of them are what? بينهما شبه, they resemble each other. من جهة, from one angle, which is what? أن كل منهما, both of them are used for في غير ما وضع له in other than what it was used for. ويفترقان and they go separate. من جهة أن المعنى الحقيقي في الحقيقة العرفية مهجور منسي والمعنى الآخر مشهور متبادر إلى الذهن. Let's go back to the example I gave you before. The word here, when the man made the oath that he's not going to ride a riding beast, but we left what usage? The linguistic usage. What did we jump to? حقيقة عرفية we took. Over the حقيقة لغوية. So it moved to a usage that it wasn't placed for. Because in that language it's used as what? In the language it's used as على كل ما يدب على الأرض. But here you didn't use it for that. You used it specifically for what? ذات الأربع من الحيوان. صحيح؟ So you've moved from the linguistic meaning and you chose to take a meaning that it was not placed for. لكن what's the difference between that and the majaz? The difference between that is the حقيقة عرفية came when the linguistic usage was boycotted and abandoned. And it was forgotten. لكن the majaz comes about, the majaz comes when you say the word asad, straight away what comes to your mind? حيوان مفترس. It's not abandoned. The word asad in its original meaning is not abandoned, it's not boycotted. You would recognize it straight away that he's a lion. In the middle of the conversation, in the middle of the sentence, he will then mention a external evidence to show you that he's talking about a man. So the original usage in the haqiqa urfiya is nasiyan masiyan, no one would know it. Like in the majaz, the original usage is what? Al-mutabadhiru ila dhihni. It is what hastens to the mind. Okay? It is what hastens to the mind. وَالْمَجَازُ لَا يَصِحُ إِلَّا بِشَرْطَيْنِ. The majaz is not correct unless there's two conditions met. There's no majaz unless there's two conditions met. The first condition is أَنْ يُوجَدَ دَلِيلٌ صَحِيحٌ يَمْنَعُ مِنْ إِرَادَةِ الْمَعْنَى الْحَقِيقِي هُوَ مَا يُسَمَّى فِي عِلْمِ الْبَيَانِ بِالْقَرِينَةِ. There has to be a authentic, correct, strong evidence that prevents from the ma'an al-haqiqi coming to place. And that is what they call in ilm al-bayan. Balagha is three types. In ilm al-balagha, they learn three sciences in there. Ilm al-bayan, ilm al-badi' and ilm al-ma'ani. Ilm al-bayan is what you study in al-majaz and al-haqiqa. Okay? Here, in that science, ilm al-bayan, they study in there that the majaz is not accepted unless there is in it an evidence, a correct evidence, that prevents from the literal meaning, the haqiqi meaning that was there originally, not to be used anymore. It can't be used. For example, a person says, رَأَيْتُ عَيْسُ أَسَدًا يَخْطُبُ. The word يَخْطُبُ will prevent you from it. It will stop, it will push you. It's called a qarina. علم البيان, they call that what? A qarina. Because I thought when you said رَأَيْتُ عَيْسُ أَسَدًا, a lion. To this point, I thought you were talking about actual lion. Because that is المتبادر إلى الذهن. That's what hastens to the mind. But what did you say? يَخْطُبُ. This is دليل صحيح يمنع. It prevents me من إرادة المعنى الحقيقي. I can't bring the original meaning anymore. I can't bring حيوان المفترس into the discussion. Because you've come with something strong. So they said the first condition for a majaz to come is there has to be a قرينة. Has to be a qarina. If there's no qarina, humil al-lafz, the word will be taken back to al ma'na al-haqiqi. The word will be left at its original meaning, its original usage. There is no such a thing or qarina here now. We can't see any qarina. You say ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. Okay, I'm taking this as a real lion you saw, because you didn't bring any dalil yamna'u. يمنع من إرادة المعنى الحقيقي. And here at this point, I'm standing on the قاعدة, which is الأصل في الكلام الحقيقة. The أصل of speech is حقيقة. Okay, the أصل is حقيقة. If a person says, no, he was metaphorical in the way he was speaking, he now is moving from the أصل, he needs to bring the evidence. He needs evidence. لو يعطى الناس بدعواهم لدعى رجال أموال قوم رجال أموال قوم ودماءهم. If everybody was given what they claimed, then everybody would claim the wealth and the money and whatever they want. But here was it, وَلَكِنَّ الْبَيِّنَةَ عَلَى الْمُدَّعِي وَالْيَمِينُ عَلَى مَنْ أَنْكَرَ. Anyone who claims that this is majaz, evidence. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you're truthful, bring your evidence. If not, then we leave this speech in its حقيق, literal meaning. It is literal meaning. There was a debate that happened between the fuqaha. I'm going to give you that as an example. The fuqaha had a debate and a discussion, which is based on the hadith in Sahihain, that the Prophet said, Al-bayyani bil-khiyani ma lam yatafarraqa. Al-bayyani bil-khiyani ma lam yatafarraqa. We have here, in this hadith, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-bayyani, the two people who are buying from one another, bil-khiyani, they have a choice. Whether they want to take these products from one another or whether they want to return it. They have the choice. مَا لَمْ يَتَفَرَّقَ, as long as they do not depart from one another. The departing here, it's taken back to the urfi, what they consider in the urf and the custom. Okay, so it means physically leaving each other, and whatever's done on other platforms, it's based on the custom of what is considered that you went your separate ways. Okay, Shafi'iyya and the Hanabila, from this hadith, they accepted a concept called an argument that they brought, which is khiyar majlis. That the person has a khiyar majlis. They have a choice to whether they want to take the product or whether they want to reject the product. They have khiyar majlis. The khiyar is three types: khiyar majlis, khiyar shart, and khiyar aib. But here we're just talking about khiyar majlis. Khiyar majlis. This hadith, the Shafi'i and the Hanabila on one side, they took from this hadith khiyar al-majlis. Hanafiyya and the Malikiyya rejected the concept of khiyar al-majlis. Why? Because they said the word al-bay'ani here doesn't mean the two people who are buying. It means al-mutasawimaini. The two people who are huggling. And they are, huggling on the price. Everyone is saying, put the price down. No, I want to buy it for this. They said the word al-bay'ani goes back to al-mutasawimaini. It doesn't go back to it goes to the moment that one is saying to the other, they have the choice. But once he takes the product, and the other one takes the money, no one is allowed to come back from it. And they said that this hadith, first of all, it's, the word al-bay'ani, that's what it means. It means al-mutasawimaini. Okay? And they brought the ayah, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, awfu bil-uqood. Fulfill the promises that you made and the contracts. Uqood here is talking about the transaction that you did. Uqood is a transaction. Fulfill them. So you can't come back from it. The scholars, they responded and they said two answers. The first answer is the word al-bay'ani. Why have you moved it from its haqiqi usage? And why did you go to a majazi usage when there's no dalil for it? Okay, there's no dalil yamna'u min iradati al-ma'na al-haqiqi. It can be taken at its literal meaning. Are we all together? Second thing is that ya ayyuhalladhina amanu awfu bil-uqudna. It's a general evidence, and this is specific evidence, and you can't bring a specific in contradiction to the general. لأن الخاص يقدم على العام, because the specific is given precedence over the general. That's the response they gave. The second condition for the majaz is أن توجد علاقة بين المعنى الحقيقي والمعنى المجازي. There has to be a relationship. There has to be a relationship between the حقيقي usage and the حقيقي usage and the majazi usage. There has to be a relationship between the two. علاقة means الصفة التي تربط بين المعنى الحقيقي ومعنى المجازي. It's a rope that connects the two. Meaning that Arabs have to be ones who used to use this in this way. For example, if a man says, رأيت بيتا, I saw a house, and he's referring to Zayd. I saw a house. And then he says, that I'm referring to Zayd. It will be said to him, how are you referring to Zayd? He goes, سميتُ بيتاً مجازاً. I already said that out of majaz, you know, metaphorically. It will be said to him, لم يصح, what you said is wrong. لأنه لا توجد في اللغة. In the Arabic language, there is no علاقة. What's the tie and the relationship between Zayd and a house? There's no علاقة. And the Arabs, they have made, the Usuliyin, they made the علاقة reach 30 plus alaqas can they mention that can exist. Like this one is not alaqa. Like in calling a woman a bait, in the Arabs they know that. As the poet said, "Mali ida jadabtuha sa'aytu akibarun alani am baitu." When the poet man he threw the rope into the well and he said, "Mali, why is it ida jadabtuha when I pull it out sa'aytu?" I say, akibarun alani. Did a woman climb me? Akibarun alani. Oh, I'm an old age has climbed me. Meaning, has the responsibility of a woman been placed on top of me? Or am I old in age? I mean, those are the two things that take away from the person, the enthusiasm that they had. But who what did he refer to as a woman? Baytu. So the Arabs do have that. To call the woman a bait. But not the men. Not a man. So here the alaqa is missing. The second condition is missing. So we first have to find, there has to be a qarina. The second one, it has to be a alaqa. The first is a qarina, and the second is alaqa. Wal majazu naw'an. The majaz is two types. The first type is majaz mufrad. The types of majaz is two types. The author mentioned this for you. The first one is majaz mufrad. It's a majaz on a wording. It's a word majaz. It falls into the alfaz, one particular word. For example, I'm going to give you many examples, but first of all, and there are two types. The first type, al-majaz mufrad, it comes in two ways. It comes in two forms. The author mentioned both of them for you. The first one is, أن تكون العلاقة بين المعنى الحقيقي والمجازي المشابهة. Pay attention to this. The حقيقة that you have here, and the thing that you're using it for, the majaz, there is between them a relationship called mushabaha. It's mushabaha. It's resemblance. Pay attention. The alaqa between the alaqa is between them. The haqiqa that you have and the majaz here is mushabaha. Example is ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. What is it that you're trying to take from it? The alaqa here is mushabaha. You're resembling the human here, this individual, to the lion in bravery. The mushabaha is bravery. You're comparing them, you're resembling them too. Okay? You say, ra'aytu qamaran, I saw a moon. What do you mean by it? A beautiful woman. A beautiful woman. This type, the Sheikh mentions it to you, which is tashbih, coming from majaz and, so pay attention, tashbih married majaz, they got married, the child that comes out is called isti'ara. The author mentioned that to you. What did we just see right now? Majaz, right? Majaz mufrad, right? The majaz mufrad, the first type is the one that comes in the form of tashbih. Come through the alaqa, the relationship, the way it comes is tashbih. Ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. It's majaz. Why is it majaz? You're using lion for a person who isn't a lion. You're using a lion for not what it was placed for. Sah, that's majaz. And there's also tashbih there. Tashbih here means courage. Courageous, shaja'ah is in this man. If majaz and tashbih get married, the child that comes out is called isti'ara. So this first type is called isti'ara. It has to be isti'ara. Like, pay attention, the tashbih that you're using has to be well known in the haqiqa. The tashbih that you, for example, what did we say? Ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. I saw a lion. What do you mean I saw a lion? Straight away, everyone here would understand as bravery. Okay, everyone knows bravery in a lion. So automatically people understand when you speak like that, people are going to understand you're talking about a courageous person. Are we all together? Like if you say, Ra'aytu asadan, I saw a lion. And then you say, but I didn't mean bravery. I meant that the mouth of this person smells bad. This person's mouth smells very bad. And it's true, the lion's mouth does smell very bad. Because he kills and he eats and he takes meat. So you're saying, I'm trying to compare that. No, nobody uses that in that context. Even if it's present in that one, but it's weak or unknown, or nobody credits that. Like in shaja'ah. So you have to make sure the haqiqah that you're taking it from, and the thing that you're going to be using it for, that the tashbih is known. Okay, that the tashbih is known. It's present in both. It's famous, it's well known. The second type is the alaqah, the relationship. This time it's not mushabaha, it's not resemblance. Before was what? Majaz? Tashbih and majaz? Got married. Here there's no tashbih. There's no tashbih. It's anything other than tashbih. This type is called majaz mursal. It's called majaz mursal. And the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned for you, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, the types of alaqat that can happen in the majaz al-mursal, other than tashbih, right? Tashbih is only in the isti'ara. This one is not in the isti'ara. This is not isti'ara. This is called majaz mursal. The reason why it's called mursal is what? It's just unrestricted. It's other types of alaqat. The alaqa can be number one, sababiyya. It can be al-musabbaba. It can be al-ziyada and it can be al-hadd. And there's many more, but we're just going to mention those four, inshaAllah ta'ala. What is as-sababiyya? Sababiyya means you call something based on the name of the reason it came from. For example, the example that Shaykh Muhammad Salih Uthaymeen gave, I'll give what he gave. He said, رَعَيْنَا الْمَطَرَ. We took care of the rain. رَعَيْنَا الْمَطَرَ. We took care of the rain. Here what they mean is, we took care of the vegetations and the grass and the greenery. But they called the greenery and the vegetation and the crops, they called it rain instead of calling it nabat, is because the nabat, the reason for it to come about is the rain. So the alaqa here is called alaqa sababiyya. You're referring to something based on the reason it came about. Wal musabbaba is the direct opposite to the first example that I just gave. It's the opposite. It's tasmiyah to shay, is to name something bismi musabbabi, based on the musabbab. For example, Allah says, وَيُنَزِّلُ لَكُم مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ مِّن رِزْقٍ وَيُنَزِّلُ لَكُم مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ رِزْقًا. Allah, He sent down from the sky provision. Now Allah didn't send down from the sky provision. Allah sends down from the sky rain. But Allah referred to the, He mentioned the rizq and He intended the rain. Why? Because الرزق مسبب عن المطر. The rizq, what does it come from? It comes from the rain. The third type is الزيادة. You're adding an additional thing in there. Such as ليس كمثله شيء. The kaf here, they say is زائدة. It is an additional to the negation of the resemblance here. ليس كمثله شيء, you say. The word مثل and ka is the same, they say. So they say the kaf is za'idah. If you look at the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he keeps using the wordings. If you look at the book, the matan, what does he say? مثلوا للمجازي. مثلوا للمجازي. He used the word مثلوا. They gave an example. He keeps saying, فقالوا, they said. Why would he say that? إشعار بأنه لا يرتضي هذا التمثيل. He's not happy with these examples. It seems like the Shaykh is just mentioning it because that's what they said, and that he's not pleased with it. Number four is al-hadfu, the fourth type of al-majaz mursal, the alaqa of the majaz mursal. The fourth one is al-hadfu, to remove something. As Allah said in the ayah, was'al al-qarya. Was'al al-qarya. What does it mean here? Was'al ahl al-qarya. Ask the people of the village. So the word ahl was removed here. But some of the usuliyin, because of their sick belief, they give the example of the word وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ. And they say وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ. That the amr here was hadf, like وَسْأَلِ الْقَرْيَةِ. It's removed. And this is incorrect. Because this is actually built upon a what? مَبْنِيٌ عَلَى نَفِي صِفَةِ الْمَجِيءِ عَنِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. It's built upon the what? The idea of negating Allah's descending, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you look at the grammarians, they do the same as well. The grammarians, they try to use وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ here, example as well. Because a lot of the grammarians, they have ill aqeedah. So they use it for, these ones use it in the angle of مَجَاز مُرْسَل, right? And the حَذْف of مَجَاز مُرْسَل, the أُصُولِيين. The Nuhat use it in the chapter of حَذْفُ الْمُضَافِ وَإِقَامَةِ مَقَامُهُ مُضَافُ إِلَيْهِ. That's what they use it at. حَذْفُ الْمُضَافِ وَإِقَامَةِ مُضَافِ إِلَيْهِ مَقَامَهُ. That's what they use it for. Either way, when you come to that, remember that this is built upon a belief that Allah does not descend. The second type of majaz now, we've spoken about the first one, which is called majaz mufrad. We're now moving on to the second type of majaz. It's called majaz aqli. It's a rational majaz. It's called rational majaz. And this is simple. It basically isn't in a particular wording. It's in the overall meaning. It's in the overall meaning. And it is when Allah said in the ayah, وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا. Allah attributed to al-ikhraj, the bringing out to the earth. When He's the one who does it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ, the earth, it brings out its load, its burden. وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا. لكن who is the one who brings it out? مَعَنَّ الْمُخْرِجَ الْحَقِيقِي لِلْأَثْقَالِ هُوَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Allah is the one who does it. It's like saying, بَنَى الْأَمِيرُ الدَّارَ. The king, he built the house. We all know that the king doesn't come down and take the bricks and put it on top of each other. Who is the one that built it for him? Of course, his workers and his employees did it for him. Here, we know this type is not literal, it's majaz. How do we know it? Because the word al-amiru was used. And the word amir refuses the idea of him having to do the role like that. So this is called majaz aqli. Aqlan, aqli, and we know it. Are we all together? Aqli, and we know it, that a leader will not come down and do it himself. So that's majaz al-aqli. هو إسناد فعل إلى غير من هو له من هو له لعلاقة مع وجود قرينة مانعة من إرادة المعنى الأصلي. If you want to look more into this issue in more great details, you can go to the kitab الرحلة إلى بيت الله الحرام, written by Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad ibn Amin al-Shanqiti. Go to page 191 to 266. He has Bahth Wafi. He talks about majaz, its types, and he discusses it in great details. Naam. Naam. Did you say 5 minutes?
No.
I was talking about you reading.
Oh, okay. You didn't get me first?
Oh, sorry. قال المصنف, the author said, تنبيه تقسيم الكلام إلى حقيقة ومجاز هو المشهور عند أكثر المتأخرين في القرآن وغيره. وقال بعض أهل العلم لا مجاز في القرآن, وقال آخرون لا مجاز في القرآن ولا في غيره. وبه قال أبو إسحاق الإسفرايني, ومن المتأخرين العلامة الشيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي. وقد بين شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وتلميذه وقد بين شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وتلميذه ابن القيم أنه اصطلاح حادث بعد انقضاء القرون الثلاثة المفضلة, ونصره بأدلة قوية كثيرة تبين لمن اطلع عليها أن هذا القول هو الصواب.
Note: the categorization of speech into literal and metaphorical is well known amongst many of the late comers regarding the Quran and other than it. Some of the people of knowledge said there are no metaphors in the Quran, and others said there are no metaphors in the Quran or in other than it. This was stated by Abu al-Ishaq al-Isfarayini and from amongst the latecomers, al-Allama Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and his student Ibn al-Qayyim, clarified that this terminology was introduced after the three virtuous generations. And they supported this with numerous strong evidences, bringing clarity to the one who reads it that this opinion is correct.
The author, rahimahullah, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he concluded the chapter of Al-Kalam and the categorization of al-haqiq speech into al-haqiq and majaz with a very important issue, which is whether there is majaz and the views regarding it. The majaz, whether there is majaz or not, there are four views, inshallah ta'ala. The first view is أن المجاز واقع في لغة العربي والقرآن والسنة. That there is majaz. It's in the Arabic language, it's in the Quran, and it's also in the Sunnah. This is the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. And they've given many examples for that in the Arabic language and in the poetries and in their proverbs. And they brought many examples in the Nusus al-Qur'ani wa Sunnah. And some of the examples we've already mentioned. And so they're the ones who argue that the speech تقسيم الكلام باعتبار استعماله is these two types, حقيقة and مجاز. The second are directly in opposition to the first group, which is there is no majaz in the language, there is no majaz in the Quran, and there is also no majaz in the Sunnah. This view is strengthened by Abu Ishaq al-Isfarayini, who is from the Shafi'i scholars, Abu Ali al-Farisi al-Lughawi, who is a Mu'tazili, Ibn Taymiyyah, his student Ibn al-Qayyim, and Sheikh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti. This is the view that they strengthen, and this is the view that Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen has strengthened as well. And the argument that they built this on is they say that this categorization of speech in these two types, haqiqa and majaz, they said it is taqseemun hadithun ba'da al-qurun al-mufaddala. It came about after the three noble generation. You do not hear the Sahaba saying this, nor the Tabi'een, or even the A'immatul Mu'tabareen, the considered scholars, the noble scholars, like Al-Imam Malik, and Layth ibn Sa'ad, and Al-Shafi'i, and Ahmed, and Al-Awza'i, and other than them. They didn't mention that. وَلَمْ يُنْقَلْ And it wasn't even transmitted from the scholars of the language. And it wasn't even transmitted from Sibawayhi, Khalid ibn Ahmed al-Farahidi, and others. They didn't say it. Who were the ones who brought it? The Mu'tazila. Why did they bring it? They only brought it to negate Allah's characteristics. That was a real alternative motive behind it. Because the makhasa'is, the unique things about the majaz is you can reject it. If I say to you, Ra'aytu asadan yakhtubu, I saw a lion giving a khutbah, you can easily say to me what? You mean a courageous person, but you didn't see a lion. So you can reject majaz. You can reject it. And they said that that would mean that the person can reject the Quran on that, based on that, and etc. And they said all of that which you mentioned is not majaz, rather it is uslubun min asalib al-Arab. It's the way that the Arabs spoke. Number three, that the majaz, the third view is that the majaz is present in the Arabic language, but it's not in the Quran or the Sunnah. This is the view held by Ahmad ibn al-Qadhi al-Shafi'i, Abu Abdullah al-Hassan ibn Hamid, al-Qadhi Abu Ya'la, and also Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Khuwayz Midad al-Maliki, and al-Zahiriyya, I believe that as well. And their argument is that the majaz is lying based on the apparent. From the zahir, it seems that it's a lie. So we can't say that the Quran and the Sunnah have that. They are both free from it. The fourth view is أَنَّ الْمَجَازَ غَالِبٌ عَلَى اللُّغَاتِ That the majaz is actually it's present in the overwhelming majority of the speech in the Arabic language. This is the view held by Ibn Jinni and his teacher Abu Ali al-Farisi. They said that the majaz is actually present in nearly everything that we say, that the haqiqah is very little. And they said, for example, زَيْدٌ أَكَلَ الطَّعَامِ Zayd ate the food. You would all say that that's haqiqah. He said, that's actually majaz. Why? Because when you say, Zayd, akala ta'ama, Zayd ate the food, he didn't eat all the food. They only ate some of the food, and etc. وهو قول غريب. This is actually a strange view. You can find it more in شرح الإيجي على المختصر, شرح المحلى على جمع الجوامع بحاشية البناني, الضياء اللامع شرح جمع الجوامع, إرشاد الفحول by شوكاني. You can find that in more details. If you go to روضة الناظر وجنة المناظر by ابن قدامة, you find more of it. And شيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي has a book called منع جواز المجازي في المنزل للتعبد والإعجاز. شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية in كتاب الإيمان page 73 to 99 he speaks about it. ابن القيم in مختصر صواعق المرسلة page 231 he talks about this issue in great details. And we'll leave it there inshallah ta'ala. والعلم عند الله عز وجل. And next week inshallah ta'ala we will carry on الأمر. In our next week lesson inshallah ta'ala we will do الأمر. Anything which I have said that was incorrect or wrong is from me, الشيطان, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.